Hello and welcome to Spotlight, the official podcast of GRAPPL. I'm Benno.
I'm JP.
And I'm Gareth.
And we've guilted Gareth into rejoining us on Spotlight. He missed the Lex Luger podcast over on the Patreon this weekend. So he owed us one in blood, and we traded that in to make him watch Ring of Honor. I think that's what's happened here, Gareth. You're back, mate. You still get to talk about, you know, kind of muscle-bound men, and you know, you can have a little bit of a chat about patriotic baby faces if you want. Still kind of the same thing. He didn't miss out at all.
It was just the worst thing was, I was just saying before in the pre-show, was that like was doing all that watching and not getting the payoff to be able to actually like talk about it. It was like literally I was sat there at like 7 a.m. on Saturday morning watching fucking oiled up men doing like poses and what am I doing with my life, and then like yeah, not even getting to fucking talk about it the following day, but doing all that prep and just lost some to time. But I can say that I've watched WBF now, so something, there you go, there's a hole in my knowledge base that's been filled.
Poor Steph got forced to watch that in our house. I was saying this on the show, like she was just disturbed by it, like who watches this, who's watching this for, understand why we're watching it for, you know, for the podcast, for kind of the wrestling tie-in, who, because we found out, didn't we, JP, 3,000 people bought the second WBF pay-per-view. Who was watching that just for fun? I mean, Dave Meltzer, Vince McMahon, like I don't know who the probably named the other 2,998 people, because fuck me. I understand why Vince wants to spruce it up now. It needed machine guns, it needed time travelers, it needed giants and little men and all of that.
I loved you saying there, who was watching this? No, nobody. That was the
problem. That's the answer, isn't it?
Literally nobody.
Yeah. Ninja killing, misogyny, a naked prison break.
Yeah.
There's several things going on in this. Matthew, and I read the result at the end of it all, which one of the competitors gives on halfway through.
Full on, it's like what we kind of discovered is like, I mean, we all know Vince McMahon is terrible whenever he tries to do anything that isn't wrestling, but like it's how bad it is, because all he does is try and recreate exactly what he did in wrestling. Oh, Bobby Heenan can be on commentary. Oh, me and Gene can present it. Hulk Hogan can't be here, but we can have a Hulk Hogan equivalent. It's like when he did No Holds Barred and Hogan just played another Hogan. Like he's got one lane. He knows exactly, he thinks he knows what he's doing, and I think that's what the world wants. Like, I say that, although Matty's come away from recording that show. He's been like trying to hit JP up to get Body Stars, the weekly WBF TV show. He wants to watch that now. So maybe we made one fan out of it, but I don't know. I'm not double dipping. I'm not watching that. I'm not doing a second show to do Body Stars month one.
I don't know. In 1992, Saturday night was Muscle Night on Sky Sports.
Oh, yeah. Wasn't it?
On this. I can't think of a less, like the idea of calling it a sport as well, because like Jesus, it makes that 1988 Olympic Games 100 meters final, puts that to shame, these competitions, the amount that's going through their veins, whether or not they deny it, and everything else.
That's what we learned, no matter how many like bells and whistles you can put at it, and believe me, Vince tried. You know, there was a rock star. There was, like you say, like a Terminator type guy. There was all kinds of like these fucking amazing gimmicks. But then they'd just get on stage, and what would they do? They just do the same three or four poses that they all do. So, like, it makes sense. That's why you needed a ninja. That's why you needed all. Did you get that?
Some of them did a little dance through their like routines. Oh, yeah. That used to be that was some of the
made us
laugh. But I've got to say, I enjoyed watching the full show. Like in the end, I was like,
was that one or two?
Two.
You watched two, right?
Because it was Luger, and I knew that he obviously wasn't there for like WBF one. I was like, well, you're watching it for, you know, it's a Luger show at the end of the day as well. So I watched WBF two, but just it was like watching, you know, like just getting a VHS out that was just so bad it was good, like back in the day, just some cheesy action film or something like that you'd be laughing your head off at how terrible it was, but having the fucking time of your life and, you know, enjoying it for all the wrong reasons. Like that whole, like the Jack and the Beanstalk thing, or same the older Flex and Dutchman, Barry DeMay doing his like James Bond peach fucking shagging that girl in the casino and stuff, but then like switching the drinks at the end and stuff, like, oh, like the mind of Vince McMahon, basically, wasn't it? It was just a little, like, it was just a little opening into the world of Vince McMahon's head with some of these stuff, like the guy breaking out of fucking jail and ripping all his clothes off and that. With the, just hilarious, absolutely hilariously corniest thing that you've ever seen in your life. That is fantastic. Watch it.
That's it. Yeah. What we were saying with the liberal use of the skip button, isn't it, JP? Maybe once they actually get on stage and they start posing. Yeah, move on there. You just want the wrestling vignettes. That's what you want. Then he spent more money and put more like editing power into and more like production value into than he did anything WWF in the early 90s. At that point, he's fucking cost cutting, isn't he? All the wrestlers are shrinking. He's just trying to flog the remains of the Ico Pro he's got. But that was the weird kind of, because we were saying, the other one I want to watch the American, not Family Fortunes, Family Feud, isn't it, over there, where like the bodybuilders and the wrestlers are on the two different teams. Like we were saying, Gareth, it's like, though, you could tell the wrestlers on the team, like it was like the Mountie and the Nasty Boys, and they're all kind of like, you know, the FBI is after Vince, so they're all off the steg, so they all look tiny, and there's all these fucking bodybuilders on the other side who allegedly aren't on steroids but are still like three times the size of the wrestlers. Like, it's just this weird world of haves and have-nots. That's where Vince's money and attention was.
You could tell who was allowed to still be on the fucking steds on that WBF show and who wasn't, basically.
Yeah.
Some of them were just like insane. Some of them had love handles, like me. It was like fucking, like it was unbelievable. Like the difference in the body shape, like between them. But did you watch the tug of war for it when the W? Did you watch that at all? When they look like fucking
wrestlers made them look like cunts. Wrestlers on one side, the bodybuilders on the other, and the wrestlers must have got together and like, what we'll do, we'll just let the rope go and let them fall over and we'll get the last laugh. Like that was, you can know that's like tiny wrestlers core thinking, isn't it? Like, we're gonna show those bodybuilder cunts.
And I think that was the last thing they ever did, didn't it? I think that was the last WPF thing that there ever was them losing that fucking tug of war in that way to the fucking shithouse wrestlers, just letting go of the rope. Like, we'll show these lads and their muscles and their big 300 grand a year contracts. Like,
it'd be different if if Lou Ferrigno had turned up, or Hogan hadn't been a coward, or Luger himself had got involved. He had the as we talk about on the show, had like the accidents around that time, didn't he? Coincidentally, which meant he couldn't do it. I was gonna say, like, on the show, like we talked about, we, you know, plug for the Patreon, patreon.com/grapple. You can hear us talk all about the shows and Luger's WWF career. But like, I'm just gonna throw it at you first, guys, because I was expecting. So on the show, we just did Luger's WWF career. So conversations about, well, why the fuck did it go so badly? And I think that we mostly figure out partly Luger, partly Vince, but we get into like the weeds on that. But I was expecting JP maybe to be the Luger defender from like 80s NWA. And then I remembered, no, JP fucking hated Luger in the NWA in the 80s. Are you in that same boat? We're looking for somebody to defend the name of our mate Larry. You know, he got a right rinse.
Lazy Larry.
I don't know. It was never one of my favourites. I would put it that way. Like, but I think I was just saying before to JP, like, there was that bit just at the end where Flair had gone and he was doing like the heel run with Harley Race as his manager and like Mr. Hughes as his heater and things like that. That I quite liked that as an act. And then obviously he loses to Sting at Super Bowl II and vanishes. But I thought, oh, he sort of found himself here. There's a bit of something there that you could see that could like maybe carry that forward. So I'll give him props there that he was probably like finally someone that I was enjoying like towards the end. But I mean, at the end of the day, like, he was always just one of those where he's, because there was so many proper workers around him in WCW, like, he just stuck out like a sore thumb. And unless he had Flair fucking, you know, running around for him and like making him look like $1 million, he didn't look great. I remember a Stan Hansen match that he had that I quite enjoyed, but I think it was probably because Hansen fucking laid into him like quite a bit in that one. But straight into the WWF run, he's just shite in WWF start to finish. I don't care what anyone says about any part of it, just fucking dog shit throughout. And don't get me started on what he did to the lovely Elizabeth.
Gotta say, yeah. Plus, allegedly, you know, there's that as well. That's not getting any more lawsuits coming our direction. But yeah, that was another one. Steph was shouted at the telly as well. Not a Luger fan, big Miss Elizabeth fan. But yeah, we went through. Like I said, I think JP's more team Luger was a lazy cunt. I was more team. Well, they probably should have had him win some matches. Might have helped. But all in all, it's the glorious failure. We go through all that. We go through the Lex Express. There's some amazing footage from that the song as well. What is it?
I'll be a hero.
Yeah. That might even be the intro to this again now at this point. But
it's on my wrestling playlist, that one. Always happy when I'm in the car driving along and that comes on.
Matty was saying this on Twitter. What's your 5-1 of wrestling songs that aren't on entrance themes? He had that. He had what was the other one? Start the Fire, the Brett one. Yeah, Tell Me a Lie, the Sean one.
There's the Liz and Randy Savage one. I can't remember. Oh, I hate that when I'm thinking about one song. I can't think of another song when I've got another.
You'll remind yourself of and get those tears going again, is what it is. I get it. It's all right. I
understand. Together. That's it. That the Lex Express stuff, you think like, you've got the biggest wrestling company in the world investing all this money in you and like doing this huge, like massive promotional like campaign. And you're just going about just being an absolute fucking cunt to everybody because you're not happy about being stuck on a bus for, all right, it's not going to be ideal, but it's setting you up to have the biggest payday of your career and the most success in your career. You put up with it, don't you? You put a smile on your fucking face, don't you? And just go along with it. And if you're going to fucking moan about it and just get pissed off about having to be nice to people, well, they put the belt on Brett then, don't they? Good.
They learned that as I learned way too late that Brett is usually right and Brett was better, I think, is what they found out. That was the other thing as well, because even at that point, like, there comes a point where they're just like, where Luger's complaining about being on the bus so much, they just start like, he gets like Ryanair flights to whatever state the bus is in and just joins the bus there. Like, it was away even then, you know, just bollocks. But yeah, there's a reason they go with Brett. Might be at a podcast on that. Brett was right. Retro, I don't know, maybe we could come up with something at some point. But yeah, Larry did ape being a passenger on the National Lex Express, as it says there. So yeah, but we want to hear more where that conversation came from. patreon.com/grapple as we delve into the weeds of the entire run. Even Ludwig Borger comes up and gets a little bit of props from Matty on that podcast as well. But yeah, that's I'm sure you got big memories of Ludwig Borger. It's shocking that he's a Matty guy. Him and Bastion Booger, stars of 1993 WWF. There's a reason we all tuned out, wasn't it? The reason everyone in my school stopped watching wrestling between the years 1993 and 1994 and never didn't come back till Steve Austin.
Legit shooter, no, Ludwig Borger. Like, oh, terrible.
Bam's bam.
And don't get into the other stuff. I'm sure you probably touched. I'm sure JP probably touched on the show.
The other stuff, even worse. Yeah. You mean his wrestling? Oh, wait, yeah.
The original Big Tone.
Defo. But yeah, hear all of that as we talk about the other Big Toe, Luger, all of that stuff. And yeah, that's over on the Patreon right now. This weekend, we're going to be doing a town hall with our patrons. Time to be determined. We're going to figure out when that's going to be, but it's going to be at some point this week. We're going to be doing that and just giving a bit of a feedback to the feedback, I suppose, where our patrons and our other listeners give us some feedback via polls. And we've been trialing a few different things to change a little bit of the lineup and stuff. So we'll be revealing what will be coming in the future of Grapple. All good stuff. Some of it you might already be able to see on the YouTube and on the Spotify. Where I was going to say, just quick programming notes. I'm uploading. This probably doesn't work because I'm talking to people who can hear me anyway. But just in case, if anyone's like, oh, the podcast isn't showing up on what's this app or that app, do reach out and let us know, because we are changing stuff in the background, which means it's basically boring stuff in the background is coming from Spotify now rather than our old host at Red Circle. So don't want to miss anybody out. Let us know if you're noticing anything weird. But
I'm not getting any free miniature weapons through the post anymore. What happened to them?
They're on the way. that's a special Patreon tier to get them. but is that it? Anything else we've got going on at the Patreon side, JP? Got to be a load coming up in August, isn't it? All in month.
There is. Coming as well.
You'll probably guess what we're going to review in August, but you know, 5 years on, you know, could be a hint there.
Yes, we have that. I think there's going to be some stuff around SummerSlam as well that we're going to be going into. And then we always have the weekend show as well. So if you want to see us go through and previewing everything that's going through the week, where we get our Dynamite thoughts as well, and all of the various news things that happen the moment that we finish recording. So yeah, hear all of that, go to patreon.com/grapple.
There you go. So yeah, all that good stuff over there. But yeah, we got Gareth back on for the big guns. So we're gonna obviously start in the big place. We got AEW Collision to talk about today. Get Gareth's Blood and Guts thoughts. Me and JP talked a little bit about that on the weekend show. You can get that free on the YouTube feed. We'll give G1 a little bit of lip service. I don't think I've got much to say on that this week. Dark Side of the Ring, Abdullah The Butcher coming later as well. But for all that, obviously, Ring of Honor, front of mind. Big pay-per-view happens at the weekend. At what point last week, Gareth, did you realise there was a Ring of Honor pay-per-view on Friday night? Because I'm guessing you didn't know because it wasn't purchased on the Fight account and I had to go and buy it for myself on air. So I'd heard people over the weekend say that it was a bit of a shit show, the rollout of it, because I don't think anybody understood how it was working because you could buy the pay-per-view apparently via Honor Club. At least that's what the press release said to me. Cheeky Cunts were charging $39.99 for it. It's 20 on Fight. And then on Saturday, Sunday, I think a lot of people were saying if you were an Honor Club member, and there's like, what, how many of them? Like less than 10,000. If you log on to the Honor Club, you could just play the pay-per-view. And people didn't know it was a bug or it just came with the package or whatever. So nobody, and I fucking bought on a club this morning thinking, you know, I might get a bit of use out of that. You know, it's a tenner. I'll get the pay-per-view. Maybe I could go back and, you know, relive me ROH glory days. Literally, it's on there, the listing, but when you try and play it, it doesn't play anymore. So some of these told Big Tone about that. About as organized as you probably imagine and as organized as the fucking build to this thing was last week, Gareth. It was like literally took me and JP by surprise on the weekend show. I was like, fuck, this is tonight.
Yeah. Well, given that I haven't managed to catch up on the weekend show yet, I think I found out that it was on this weekend when I said to you, like, oh, I feel guilty about missing that show. I'll do Spotlight on Monday.
Oh, no.
and then you went, right, we're doing this, this, and this. I was like, all right, well, better watch that then. So, I think that was when I found out it was happening. But I'm pleased I did.
You thought you were in the Collision to watch? You thought you were.
Well, I was thinking, oh, I'll watch some of the G1. I thought I'll pick and choose some matches there. But I think I made the right choice by going with the ROH anyway.
I will say, I tell a lie. To be fair, like the other note that I knew that it was on, apart from the press release, was that everybody except for us, and it appears to be Voices of Wrestling, got an invite to the conference call last week. I don't know if we've been left on the air. There's the haves and the have-nots in the AEW media world, but very suspicious that I know those lads are quite wondering what has caused that. I'm hoping they just forgot, you know. I've send me invites in the post of you. They're happy to send me like random, like, oh, the pay per view's on at like this cinema, or so and so is on like whatever that podcast is they do, ROH Unplugged or whatever the hook it's called. But yeah, no invite to the press last week. Thought it was downright rude. Might explain why last week I thought the press had existed purely to promote the impending debut of Sasha Banks that didn't happen, JP. But yeah, you know, would have thought big media comrades like us and Voices especially, I think, probably should have been on that list. Hopefully it was an oversight and that's all it is. Not in personal. We haven't pissed off any other promoters, have we? We've done anything. We offended them.
We never do. We've never.
Not we could have possibly done to offend Big Tom, ever.
No, exactly. There's nothing we could have said about it. And I'm sure if he went through our extensive back catalogue of this stage, he wouldn't find anything remotely offensive. And I'd say that from the very first moment we became GRAPPL, but I digress as well.
I think in protest you should stop covering ROH, Benno, full stop. Yeah. No historical ROH or anything.
But I just have to like them on the Patreon. There's a nice little button now. It's got a picture of me and my ROH track jacket, and you go straight to all the retro stuff.
I need to employ you. This is the historical stuff that works. Like
having Honor Club going back and trying to like look up what's available from the retro years, fucking hell, like there's entire years missing. There's even, it feels like there's less than there was when like Sinclair owned it. You know, the stuff's been taken down that was there in like the Sinclair version of it, which again, I don't really like. Are people really paying £10 a month to get the ROH TV? Like, I feel like they deserved this pay-per-view as a Brucey bonus, because like you see like Suit Williams reviewing this. I think he reviews it for The Observer and he's being driven stare crazy by like these random shows where it's like one week it's 3 hours, the next week it's an hour, and then it's like the week before the pay-per-view before they go, oh fuck, we better promote and build some matches here for the pay-per-view that's on Friday. I think Arthur Carr got announced on Thursday last week at this point. It begs the question of what fucking ROH even is at this point, because that was that's something that, like, you know, I joke about not getting invited to the call, but like even in like the post show presser after this pay per view, like I actually don't know exactly who it was. I've got the post wrestler right up here, but like one member of the media literally asked Big Tone, like, what's the point in ROH? Like, literally, what's the point of ROH in this 2023 landscape? It's fucking, I mean, it's a fair question, to be honest. He tried to defend it by being like, oh, you know, we exist, you know, for you know, to super save the hardcore fans, I think was the way that he answered this one. I mean, I would argue that maybe AEW does that in its own way. Is probably the truth. And yeah, he said it's got a different mission. It's got a different audience than AEW, apparently. It's more focused to a hardcore audience, and he can do things programmed to hardcores and deliver the kind of wrestling that he knows a hardcore fan wants to see. He went on about like the history of ROH and stuff like that, and why he wants to keep it alive, which, again, belt in the back, he gets my vote for that. But any by that at all, Gareth, it appeals to a different audience than AEW. It's more of a hardcore product. I mean, is it more AEW?
Who are these hardcore people then who like watch more wrestling than like you, for example? Who are these like fucking wrestling cyborgs that just like watch it absolutely constantly? It's just ridiculous. But surely hardcore wrestling fans would then, I don't know, then. Surely then it must be throwing up a load of wrestling classics then, shouldn't it? Like lads going out and just putting on these matches for the hardcore fans, these absolute five-star bangers with either, you know, loads of DA in them from a match point of view, or loads of insane shit, or like maybe some like really like gritty detailed storyline that's building into it. No, it's just Dark Elevation, isn't it? With a different logo on it, isn't it? Just a load of
random Dark Elevation
thrown together.
Dark Elevation, and then four times a year, you go, oh shit, there's a pay-per-view. Like that has never been more exposed than this one, where, again, pay-per-view itself, very enjoyable show overall. I think that, like, Forbidden Door is always the go-to example, isn't it, JP? You know, that first Forbidden Door, where the build was bad, and then the best wrestlers in the world got in there and had great matches. Not quite the best wrestlers in the world, I'd say, in this ROH show, but very, very high-level wrestlers who you go out there with a decent amount of pay-per-view time and a great crowd, they're going to give you great standalone matches, you know, the top two matches in this especially, I'm sure we're all gonna say positive things about, but you can't rely on that, can you? Because like that's what happened this time. Like I understand, you know, Eddie Kingston was plan A, he said that in the presser as well, and then he got called up to the G1. Then Mark Briscoe was plan B, and then it turned out Mark Briscoe had, you know, I'd been here for quite a while and was trying to work through it, and basically had to admit I can't wrestle Tone, so he pulled them out. So third option was Pac. But when that happened, we were talking about, weren't we, on the weekend show, JP? Like, it just exposed the fact that wouldn't have been so bad if there was an undercard. There wasn't one at the point that got pulled. They went from having one match to having no matches this time last week. And, you know, they recovered and they delivered a very good pay-per-view. And I think you've got to give credit to the wrestlers for that reason. But I don't really think Tony Khan deserves any credit. And I don't think it really defends the lack of, I don't know, purpose that this brand as in general. Like, again, they've just never really nailed down what it's supposed to be. Is it like more AEW content? Is it, as Tony Khan always talks about, its entire separate thing, which just is bollocks really when you watch it, and it's literally the cast of Rampage, isn't it? Like, what actually is it at this point?
Well, that's it. You mentioned it's what audience does this actually serve? Because if there was this television product that was kind of like different, or is being presented, like, I remember one of the ideas he said about how this could stand out is just sort of having like specials, effectively, not having a TV service, but a regular kind of like big enough event. And they've got enough of a back catalogue if they got their kind of act together, and then start thinking about building it with other kind of content. And instead, it just seems to be very similar to the Ring of Honor product before it went bust. It's just that, and Ring of Honor TV, as far, and maybe I'm wrong, I don't think there's ever been a classic episode of Ring of Honor TV. There's like some big episode of Ring of Honor on HDNet that like everyone had to see, or stuff that was even on Sinclair.
There's been some, like, around the time, there's a few good Bullet Club six-mans I could point out that had a good hour built around them type of thing.
And this will have like good matches necessarily in a vacuum and stuff like that, but there's zero builds to this. And I don't know if he's been saying in terms of the metrics and how it's trending in comparison to other Ring of Honor pay-per-views as well, but this had zero build, and it has a TV that's just replaced Dark and exists, but there's no structure to it. It's a series of matches and some segments, and that's it. So it's not even put together in any different way. So how is that going to appease a hardcore base when you're putting on what is the most just bare bones wrestling TV there is in an era where we're absolutely saturated with it? I think the one thing you have to say about it is headlining the pay-per-view with Athena and Willow Nightingale, that's something they haven't done before. And that feels like kind of like what Impact did when they were like, well, what are we going to need to do in order to kind of generate interest? And it kind of worked. It's worked for them because ultimately they've raised the credibility. It's become a genuine like a title they can headline shows with, pay-per-views. And it never feels like kind of out of place. And that's the thing with it. Like, the crowd were pretty hot. There's some really fun stuff. But I also went through this thinking, I want to see Shibata in New Japan. I don't want to see him in Ring of Honor. I want to see Aussie Open on AEW, take him on FTR. I don't want to see him in Ring of Honor. I don't want to see Samoa Joe defending a title that he just clearly doesn't give a shit about. And he's no reason to.
That's the problem with the blurred lines, isn't it? Because it's like, it's both, really. Like, is it its own separate roster? No. Is it also AEW? Well, also, no, not really. It's in this weird, mushy middle. You add to the fact that, like, you know, he was asked about whether they were going to be, you know, going back to taping them as standalone. He's like, oh, I'd enjoy that, but I kind of like the way it is, taping it with Collision. So then it's, again, it's like, it's reheated wrestling, isn't it? It's just that extra, it's a tired crowd after Collision has happened, watching the lesser than wrestlers all wrestle each other. So it doesn't save any master in that way. Like, it's like that for me, Gareth, that's its two biggest problems. One, that it's just never been, you either have to make the call, it's completely separate from AEW, and the people who appear on it, with rare exceptions, don't constantly appear on AEW TV, or it is a mix and you find the reason, like JP said there, whether it's the women's division or whatever, that makes it stand out as its own thing. And the other big problem for me, like, for that, is that it's the same fella in charge of it, and that's why I think we're in that mushy middle, because Tony Khan has only got so much brain space, and he's, you know, got the NFL's about to start, you know, Saudi Arabia trying to steal all his players and his manager with Fulham. He's trying to run Dynamite. He's trying to run Collision. He's got a stadium show coming up. He's got All Out coming up. And he's still sat there at these presses with a straight face going, yeah, I can bunk both. Yeah, it's still me. I'm still in charge. I can do this. I think he's shown he can't.
Yeah, and I think, as you say there, just I think that lack of identity is the thing that really jumps out the most. And, you know, I think in the last few weeks, you have talked about, obviously, like, Collision and the fact that it has sort of started to evolve into its own little world with its own cast of characters who are, like, recurring. And, okay, it might be a promo one week, it might be a match the next, there might be an attack the next, whatever kind of thing, but using this sort of, like, standalone set of people. And I think that's what we always said, like, you know, going right back to when ROH first was coming back, we always said that that's what it needed to be, really. And I think if he's talking about, okay, it's a product for hardcore fans, I think hardcore, like, if it was that, I think more hardcore fans would be watching it and would be, like, talking about it from that point of view as well. Because think how, you know, when we talk, how many people are on the AEW roster, and we've in the past have gone down and you make your little lists and you go, oh, it'd be a great place for, like, you know, I don't know, Daniel Garcia to learn to be the guy, or, you know, like someone like a Griff Garrison to go and get a bit of character on his own and get reps, and, you know, and so he's not just, like, cropping up in a tag and things. That's always, like, felt like what it should be, really, rather than it been, oh shit, like, yeah, we're taping ROH at the end of Collision tonight. Who's about on the roster today? Oh, you can have a match and you can have a match, kind of thing. Like, oh, he's got the ROH bit. All right, you defend it tonight against him over there. Yeah, he's in the building today. He hasn't got a match on Dynamite or Collision this week, so he can be, you know, he's got a, you know, ROH world title match. And that's the way it almost like feels, that it's just put together, that there's just these people wandering about who are under contract at AEW, and it's like, oh fuck, we've got nothing for you this week. Oh, go on, you can just be on ROH this week and have a random match. It just doesn't feel like it's got any structure. It's no sort of, like, strong purpose to it. You know, even like you say with this, like, with the pay-per-view, putting that card together and things, there's matches there that you just look at and it just feels exactly the same. And that's a pay-per-view, and some of them are title matches on a pay-per-view that just feel like it's just been thrown against the wall. I think we've seen with the best parts of Collision being that own entity, own little world. And that's what, for me, that's what ROH needs to be. That's what's going to hook me, you know, hook me into, you know, potentially pay money to actually watch it, is if it actually feels like it's got a purpose and it's got a reason to exist, kind of thing. But because the person asking that question is right, like, it doesn't feel like it's got a purpose, you know, doesn't, what is the point of ROH?
Well, it's like, I think, you know, it's clearly a dirty word in the Turner offices, isn't it, JP? Like, there's no doubt about that. I think, you know, if all things were equal, like, it would be an easy option to be like, okay, Rampage, we're not doing anything else with it. That's the ROH show now. I think that's probably the defense on the Tony Khan side. Like, because it's on Honor Club, you've got to sell subscriptions. Like, there's a barrier to entry to even watch this in the first place. I mean, on the flip side of that, there's also, you know, people are paying you money, so you better fucking deliver them something that's quality. And I'd argue they're not doing that either. But I think because that happened, and for whatever reason, he couldn't talk Turner, he could talk him to giving Collision on Saturday nights, but he, for whatever reason, can't talk them into giving him anything for ROH. Because it's buried away in the streaming service, the thought process probably is, well, we need the guys to appear on AEW TV, because otherwise, why would anybody buy the streaming service? So it's a bit of a catch-22, isn't it? But like, maybe you've just got to eat that. Maybe you have got to say Daniel Garcia is going away on excursion to this ROH product over here, and maybe you have to be creative about. Maybe there's a couple of people that you're allowed through the forbidden door, but it's not as, like Gareth says, lax it is. There's at least some rules and regulations, like one or two guys who maybe you do still see on AEW TV. Maybe people come in for guest spots, and that's how you promote that ROH is, you know, it's cool. Guess what? You know, Claudio, who's normally on AEW, is actually going to be on ROH this week. Or guess what? You know, whether it's Vikingo or whoever is going to be on ROH TV this week, maybe that would be a solution, because I think that's a big part of it. It's the fact that it hasn't got TV. That means Tony Khan's never really made a decision on what it actually even is in the ecosystem of things.
Well, that's it. And, you know, we'll be talking about sort of like where it fits in. It's not like it's creating kind of like, I mean, it's not creating stars in a level that, you know, that say like WWE, for example. One of the things they've done with NXT, it's kind of worked in some of the ratings, is by moving down a Seth Rollins for a week.
Yeah.
And has a match against a Carmelo Hayes or a Bron Breakker.
Thing. Credit where it's due. Dominic Mysterio popped a number last week.
Yeah. Yeah.
Beat the Dynamite number in overall viewers that second.
Like, you can't argue with that. And that's good. And it's a great place for him to be as well. Just saying that, just in terms of, you want him to develop on a week-to-week basis and actually have some matches, but he's kind of off the radar, but he's just completely top fucking heel. That's a masterstroke. But for this, it's like the quality of it is just really attritional, because you can't invest in really any big storylines or anything else. The one they would have had isn't really a storyline. If they'd had Mark Briscoe there, which is still the plan, I think they should stick to, if with that, just move away from Eddie Kingston, just get him onto AEW. But
yeah,
like with that, they just need that dividing lines, and it's just a justification for how much he spent on it. But he is ultimately, Tony Khan is the issue. You talk about like trying to rebrand it and other things like that. That requires him to leave the room.
Yeah.
And actually have other people have this conversation and say, I need to hand this off. And it's not like he doesn't employ a fuck ton of people who were there when Ring of Honor was kind of like, what made Ring of Honor work? And then think to themselves, like, create something. I mean, EC, I know this is a, it's not like a like comparison. ECW was the promotion where the hardcores came to. How did they do that? Like, you know, a combination of bringing in people and having kind of better matches than were on, you know, WWF and WCW. But then they also had like good storylines. And that's a thing that this just misses. And it just sort of becomes anonymous wrestling.
Just needs other voices in the room.
And it does need other voices in the room.
Or a voice that's not Tony Khan, like you said. That's the biggest thing. Because that's what, I think, to talk the positive, I think that's what this main event felt like. It didn't feel very Tony Khan to be like, you know, yeah, our main event was in the mud. And, you know, Eddie Kingston wasn't there. Mark Briscoe wasn't there. Again, we can argue about whether Kingston should be there or not. He's probably too big a star to siphon off to ROH. You know, there's other guys you could maybe have had in that role. But he was their guy. That fell apart. They didn't have a proper main event. So, you know, or at least from a men's point of view for the world title. And I think we all kind of, I would just expect it. They'll just go, fuck it. We'll just put Pac and Claudio in the main event. And they're so good that they'll pull it off regardless. that was, like you said before, that little bit of thinking outside the box, putting Athena versus Willow Nightingale in the main event, because that was supposed to be the point of AEW at the start, wasn't it? Like, AEW was going to be like the promotion where, yes, the world title match, the men's world title match would often be the last match, but you might get the tag title match main events, as we've talked about Spotlight a little while ago. Still won't happen that, you know, or the women's title might be able to, the women's world title might be able to main event on shows. That hasn't happened yet either, and probably is miles away from ever happening. I love that they did that here, because, like, credit where it's due. For a pay-per-view I had very limited expectations for, I thought the big matches really delivered here, and chief among them was this. I think they went out there and they just, you know, knew the spotlight was on them, knew this was a hell of an opportunity. It wasn't even really built up that much as like this big deal that there's a women's match in the main events. They just went out there and did it and absolutely killed it. Like, you know, despite the, like I said before, the criticism we might give the booking and the criticism we might give Tony Khan, criticism of ROH's existence in the first place, you can't ever go with the wrestlers. And like I say, JP, the headline here is Athena and Willow Nightingale went out there and had, you know, one of the best matches of the week this week.
Absolutely, they did. And it's not really a surprise to me. I mean, Athena's been really good in this, right? It's like she's found herself. We are a world away from like Ember Moon. She's confident, but also I kept on thinking she should be on AEW because she just has that kind of driven loner shit kicker thing that really we've not seen. I think Serena Deeb might be the closest kind of comparison to that kind of character that they've had in the women's division.
Totally.
Like a bit of a bully. And she'd be great in there as well. And Willow Nightingale, they've just like kind of found her. And it's really strange because that New Japan beating Mercedes Moné has done stuff, even as weird as like the events of it coming around and it got coming from an audible from her.
Yeah.
And she's just progressed in every single way. And it doesn't feel like we've seen with a lot of like false dawns in and around like the AEW's women's division, because that's really what this is, that she can actually like live up to it. She's got better in the ring as well. You can't like kind of, you know, the level of crowd connection and charisma, they just like fans have gravitated to her. Load of signs, but it wasn't a big crowd. I mean, it was not much over 2,000 people. And they're being a bit guarded around the numbers, which always makes me kind of wonder how many comps for this one on here as well. But like, she needs polish, but you can't teach charisma. And she's got it in fucking spades. Absolutely like likability. I was just shocked she didn't win. But the match was good enough that it was like that wasn't going to necessarily matter to the crowd as well. And it is one of the few storylines that they've apparently been telling on Ring of Honor television. Yeah, they should have made a much bigger deal of it, really.
That's why it deserved the main, wasn't it? Were you a fan of this one, Gareth?
Oh, I absolutely loved this. I mean, like, it was one of those where I'd, like, just watched it there and I was just buzzing all the way through. I think it was the best match that I've watched for a couple of weeks, or match that I've enjoyed the most for a couple of weeks. I know last time I was on Spotlight, I was like waxing lyrical about Willow Nightingale, and I was thinking, oh God, am I just going to be like popping up for another appearance on Spotlight and just banging on about Willow Nightingale again? But
Marina Lizzie Evo, mate.
I think I am, though. This pair, like, they've just got such great chemistry, haven't they? Like, they had that match in the Owen Hart semi-final like a couple of weeks ago, and it was only a 10-minute match, but it was really good. Like, it was like they did so much in that 10 minutes and just worked so well together that when I saw that this was the main, I was like proper excited to watch it, because I still had that one like fresh in my mind. And like, as you know, totally echo your thoughts there about like Athena, the development that she's had, and like I think having this run where she's like been sort of injury free as well and been able to just like wrestle loads and things, whereas obviously injury is something that had like hampered her quite a bit in the past. She looks fucking great. Like, you know, I honestly don't think I've enjoyed watching any wrestler more than Willow Nightingale this year. Every time I watch her, she's just that natural charisma, that connection, that ring work has improved so much. Like, and putting in like a match like this where, you know, this was like fast. This was, you know, there was room for error here. The pace that they were working at, and especially the how much they were like laying it in at points as well. Like, you know, there was definitely things here where 2 years ago she'd have struggled, but she kept completely up to the pace. Everything was as felt like really smooth. Just felt like hard hitting as fuck, and like God, I enjoyed it so much. And I think like one of the things that was like I enjoyed so much, you know, You know, I like the I like wrestling to look like a competition and people trying to win and things like that. That came through so much in this. It was two people going for it, legitimately trying to beat each other. And there was that sort of like storyline wrinkle about them hitting finishes of other women wrestlers that, to be honest, probably would have bypassed me if I didn't have the commentary like referencing, so you know, some of those in different areas.
But Daisy Hayes,
it just didn't matter though. Like to me, they were just absolutely just, you know, they were just both legit. It made the title throughout the match feel a bit more to me. Like it really felt like they were. It was something that was like really on the line and something that they were like really like cared about, like trying to win this match. I absolutely loved it. And some of those kickouts at the end, like I think where again it was a match where it wasn't overblown, you know. There was a couple, you know. I think there was a one where like Athena hit the O face and, you know, Willow kicked out at 2.999, and the crowd was so invested that they went fucking bonkers when she kicked out. And okay, it's a small crowd, but right there in the palm of their hands, like absolutely brilliant. And then I think a minute later, Willow hit the powerbomb, and then Athena kicked out, and you know, you got like a similar reaction. You know, they worked it brilliantly. And just for in a time period where I feel like I've watched a lot of matches that have had overstayed their welcome and had too much, you know, going on in the finishes, and just like maybe ran 10 minutes more than they should have. This was, God, what is this, 20-minute match that felt like it was a 10-minute match, like the Dynamite one. It absolutely flew by, you know, loads to it, and God, enjoyable as fuck.
Well, you're on mute.
There we go. Felt like a peak NXT match for me, which can be good and bad. Like, the only negative I would say, to be honest, I didn't love those callbacks. It felt a bit FTR to me. Felt a bit NXT to me. Felt a bit like melodramatic type of thing. But like you said, if I didn't know, I probably would have enjoyed it more. Like not knowing, oh, that's Daisy Hayes' old finisher or whatever like that. It was a little bit like too on the nose. But it felt like an old NXT match in the way of like just having that like smaller, hardcore live crowd biting on all those near falls and living and dying with those near falls for an ROH women's title match, you know, which has not been, you know, the highest prestige belt, you know, when it comes to this company. It's a place to build off, isn't it? Like, as a match, I'd probably go 4.25 on it. It sounds like maybe Gareth, you might go higher. I don't know about you, JP. 4.25 for you?
4.25 for me.
Yeah, I'd be in that. It was one of those where it's like in the realm. It's a high 4.25, I would say. I probably wouldn't go like 4.5 on it, but like it's a really good, strong 4.25 that I'll remember. Like, you know, like if we're having conversations in a few months' time, I'll definitely remember this match. Whereas there's plenty of matches that you give 4.5 to in the moment that you forget about tomorrow, okay? Or you forget about in a month's time. This one will stick in my head.
The thing with this as well is this needs to be booked when NXT would do well occasionally, which is you basically elevate an entire feud from developmental up to the main roster, and you have that as an undercurrent. Like you know, Owens and Sami Zayn is probably the example of using the various kind of bits of history, and they should be doing that with them. But that's where I kind of come to the point of this. As much as I love the match, I want to see both of them in an AEW's women division. Because it would be...
This is the problem, innit? We talk about how can you make ROH better, and then there's a way you can, and our immediate reaction is put it on AEW. Does that not sum up the problem?
If you turned Rampage into an AEW women's show, I'm sorry, I'm boring at this point so many times. You put these characters in the ecosystem with everybody else, and that's interesting dynamics. And you kind of just book it in that way, where they are, like Collision, isolated in a sense in their own kind of universe where they get to kind of do what they want. And I think you start to see people like you'll see even more from them as well, rather than them kind of ending up in like where Honor Club is, where it's just kind of isolated. It's not being seen in front of that many people.
I thought that Athena was really going to be like the savior of like the AEW women's division at one point, and then she's just become the forgotten woman. I just hope this is a way to, like kind of just springboard and just be like, I'd rather, again, I push back a little bit because I'm like, well, they also need, this is a way they've shone a light on ROH, so it's like, well, maybe they should lean in that direction. But at the same time, you got a Collision where Taya Valkyrie got like a full segment, and you know, post-match angle, and it was like, why is that happening when these two are over here? You know, so like there is, I feel like Tony Khan in that way, where there is that lap to and I'm going, but there's got to be a, like a happy solution for all sides, because yeah, it was absolutely like Gareth said, that I think this is going to be the abiding memory of this pay-per-view. I mean, we don't have to go long on it on any of the rest of it, but like of the other big matches, any hot takes on those? Pac and Claudio was at a, it was like the high end of professional wrestlers having a professional wrestler match for me.
Yeah.
This was like, maybe like, it's the Benno 3.75, I'd say. I mean, it's a ice cold match. You can tell me there was a build up of blood and guts, and the Pac walking out the cage justified this match. I mean, and also you got the problem where, like, is Pac a babyface? Is he a heel? Claudio, if anything, was the one who was leaning babyface in a lot of moments in this match. It was basically heel versus heel, wasn't it? So there was only so much you could do to heat it up. No one believed Pac was going to win. But despite a lot, the mechanics of everything he did was still very good, wasn't it? And it was, you know, worked well. You know, the big spot with Pac going through the table, like he's just got a taste for that after the blood and guts last week. I'm going to remember that like distinctly. But outside of that, it was just a really well worked professional wrestling match that belonged in its place in the card. I think it couldn't have gone past this, but second from last, thought this was a really decent semi-main event.
Given the state of what happened with the main events of going from Eddie Kingston to Mark Briscoe, they just had to put a match together, and they had a very good match. And if this had been the main event and not Athena Willow Nightingale, it would have been one of the things like the stick they would have got for it as well. And it had enough of those kind of distinguishing spots, I think, to take out of Gentleman's 3 into, I don't know, a Toff's 3.75, where it gets more upper class than a gentleman. like at that point in time, like it's very, very good, but it doesn't have the stakes. And you know that this is just it's an exhibition, and it's there to fill a gap. And it's like, I've seen when Pac first came out in the Indies, plenty of Pac exhibition matches, which are very, very good, but they're very hard to be emotionally invested in when you kind of realize, oh, it's going to just go to a draw, isn't it? Because that's the
at least he could job here, yeah.
and it was screwy enough, and it's just like what's leading to BCC versus Death Triangle stuff. And it's just like, can we just have some fucking singles feuds and stuff, and you can coexist, you can still be mates, but you don't have to have these. And it was afterwards, it just turned into all of these people then running down in various ways, where you end up with the Best Friends music playing people out, because Ring of Honor, who's apparently like a producer on the show as well, which sounds a bit nuts.
Orange Cassidy.
Orange Cassidy. And you just think, how do we get to that from like the main event between Claudio and Pac?
Yeah, it's Pac. Like I saw it, Claudio in the presser, like he was in his typical kayfabe mode, but like somebody asked him, oh, did you ever consider dropping the Black Belt Combat Club name? And he's like, well, why would we, you know, we're still friends with Regal, so yeah, it still makes sense. I was like, fuck off, that's not dying anytime soon, is it? But like it's like that, and like and more than that though, I think Pac and Phoenix and Pentagon, you ever seen a stable with less chemistry than those lads? Like, could you imagine them knocking around outside the wrestling with Alex Abrahantis in tow? Like, it's just the worst. Just get him away from them. Let Pac be Pac. He doesn't need, you know, Phoenix and Penta as well. Again, it's the sum of the parts thing we've always said about them, isn't it? Penta was always better away from Phoenix, and Phoenix is better away from Penta. But even as a team, they've got more value than they do as a six-man thing. It's, yeah, it sums a lot of problems up, I think, that post-match there.
Oh, 100%. And it probably just like goes back to, I mean, JP was just saying about that, about like Athena, almost this person just been this sort of like one person who's an island, who's a bit of a shit kicker kind of thing. And like that, to me, that's what Pac kind of should be, this sort of like loner. Like you say, like he just doesn't, that mix with the team just doesn't work. I mean,
bad news Brown, mate.
Yeah, that's it. 100%. Nailed it, JP, there. Like that's what he just this angry little fucker who just goes about and just, you know, you can move him up and down the card as needs be, fill in everywhere. You know, he's always going to have late matches to a certain level. I mean,
somebody who wants to like get a world title shot for the next pay-per-view. They can beat Pac. He can be their feud before that. You know, not just a throwaway. He's that guy. He's the gatekeeper. That's his role. Yeah. Like, he'd be perfect.
100%. And the post-match angle here was just weird. The match itself was fine for me. Like, I was probably flitting between 3.5 to 3.75. So it's on the, you know, where if the Athena Willa Nightingale was ticking up towards 4.5, this one was like at the bottom. If it was a 3.75, it was at the bottom end of that for me, really.
Grapple's
just
dead now, JP, and he's doing fractions. We're on points of a star. What's going on?
I thought he was going to say scrape to B minus then. Really, what he's saying there, an old man.
Maths is dead. You know, he'll be doing minus stars next. That's coming. Zeros. A zero isn't allowed now, Gareth. Come on,
old man. 60.6%.
Now that there's no technological limitations behind it, I've got free reign. Do what we want. But yeah, really? I've got nothing to say about this other than that spot that you mentioned there. That was cool as fuck. The sort of the gorilla press to the outside through the table, but everything else was just like a wrestling match that was happening that felt like it had no real stakes because he was never going to win anyway. And then, you know, it was just a match. Mm. Yeah.
But the other notable match on the show, maybe Shibata Garcia. I know you saw that one as well, Gareth. Shibata's definitely pushing it now, isn't he? He's definitely doing more and more and more. Like, he was another good one in the post show presser where he was using like a Google Translate app on his phone to thank Tony Khan for, in his words, making him a wrestler again. It was nice to see, also slightly worrying. But you know, I'm not saying we're back to the Shibata of old, but he's definitely doing a lot more than he was up until this point, JP. And I think he's been given free rein a little bit with this pure title run. I didn't expect to get this much Shibata, but it's still, you know, it's still diet Shibata, but very much enjoyed. And I think he makes for a good foe for Garcia. His silly Alex Wright dancing.
Yeah, this moved at a really good pace. And it had those kind of exchange spots. As I thought the suplex one, I was like, I don't know if I've seen this, where you have the kind of combating suplex bits in there as well. And it didn't feel like a pure rules match, probably. It just sort of felt more like a serious. Yeah. Like I saw about the rope breaks and I was like, I didn't even think about them at the stage, even though like it's there along with the time of the match. Like it just sort of really sailed through. It's just that, this is good. I'm sure we've seen this. This might be the Mandela effect. You could be telling me it's the first time they ever fought each other, but I feel I've seen these two fight at least a couple of times. Certainly,
like four ways, three ways, lots of all that, yeah.
All of that stuff as well. It's just that, like, this needs to be the kind of almost house style of it, like treat it like the New Japan TV belt, where it just moves at a quicker pace. Like, I think that would be something that would really go for it. But I just want New Japan to shit or get off the pot with Shibata to say, no, we're not booking you. And let him go if that's going to be the case. If he's going to do it, and he's going to get booked for doing it. It's just that Katsuyori Shibata kind of works in Japan. Like, you know, you think of the reactions, you think of the position he was at before he got that injury as well. And he's just working again, and he's kept himself in top-notch nick because he's become one of the greatest, I don't know, he's become like Kenny Dalglish in 1986, isn't he? He's just like a player manager, like just bringing through players and smart transfers and the rest of it. And it's just like, I just want to see him in New Japan, not Ring of Honor, even in AEW doing something as like this shit kicker going near the world title, something different. Sorry.
It's fine. I'm just saying, I'm looking at his cage match just based on you saying that. You know, last thing he did, UWF Rules, the Tom Lawler match in Japan in December. And then after that, it's literally just ROH. And he's had like about 6 or 7 matches, a couple of AEW TVs, Rampage and Dynamite, the tag with Garcia that you're remembering. That probably tells you something, though. Probably tells you something about how New Japan just don't want him in there.
Did I read that he's no longer coaching at the dojo? Is that right?
Yeah, apparently he's not.
You know, so there's that connection as well. That's sort of lost a bit there. I mean, to be honest, I was low on this. It was a 3.25 for me. Like, it just felt like nothing. It just felt like there was stuff that was happening there in the match that you were just thinking, God, I've seen so many better versions of this from other people and Shibata himself in his prime doing better stuff than this. It just felt like going through the motions, this for me, trying to put on that style of match for that sake, and I don't know. I'm just.
But you think of dancing Garcia?
The dance, like, I get some people are enjoying it and stuff like that, but for me, where you're starting a match with Shibata and it's all quite serious and things, and then suddenly you're fucking dancing in his face. Dancing in his face when it's cross legs or trying to dance your way out of a sleeper. Like, you know, I'm just a bit like, oh, this is
gosh, so you said that because I was like mining for news for like the daily updates, so I'm full of these quotes today. Because basically that's what passes for news these days, as you know, JP, quotes from wrestler interviews.
Oh.
So I can't help but read them. And like Garcia did say, oh, he's like, you know, yeah, I've, you know, this gimmick really brought, you know, something out of me. People just thought I was a technical wrestler, and now they think, you know, I'm more than that. And it's like, but do they, or do they think you're a technical wrestler who does a funny dance now? Like, I'm probably tied to this argument because I was very negative on the gimmick at the start, and I think I've got to begrudgingly accept that, like, it has brought maybe something out of him. But I still don't agree that it, like, the early days of Tony Khan ROH, when, you know, he was just being a cocky shit who thought he was above the pure division, couldn't have brought the personality out of him too without the wacky dancing. But
this is, yeah, not, you know, a better version of Daniel Garcia at all. Like, okay, that dance, some crowd people in the crowd laugh along with it and things like that, and it creates a bit of engagement. There's more in his locker on the serious side of Daniel Garcia that will get better crowd reactions than that by being seriously good at being being a seriously good wrestler who's who comes across as fucking hard. Like, personally, I think this is like shifting people into territories of, you know, this, I mean, I know it's the whole like meta sports entertainer kind of thing, but this is just, to me, it's in the realms of potentially career damaging. Like, it feels like it could be one of those things that becomes hard to shake, sort of thing, that like he becomes so associated with doing that stupid dance, but like that then it's almost like an expectation or something like that. And then the dance becomes more than the wrestler, or the dance becomes more than the character. Yeah. And, you know, I don't want him to get into fucking Red Rooster territory where suddenly he's got his career's a bust because he's dancing Danny Garcia, you know.
Alex Wright, Disco Inferno. Like, I don't even think it is a fully fleshed out character. It's a character in the sense of Kevin Nash gave the X Division guys, like, oh, you're this now. You know what I mean? Like, oh, Sanjay Dutt, this was your offensive gimmick now. You know, everyone got like a character. You know, Jay Lethal became Macho Man. And to be fair, that's a good example because it followed him then around for the rest of his career, didn't it? You know, saying that. Straight up boots and trunks, Jake Little doesn't really light my world on fire either. But I think there's more there with Daniel Garcia. And yeah, as Steph said, it's gone on too long. Got to pull back before as well. Will mentioned Death Triangle's been going on for 3 years. This is the problem with Tony Khan. He has a bad idea. He will eventually change course. It'll just take a while before you get there. QTV still exists, you know. probably going to be another couple of years of Garcia doing this. He's going to be defined, isn't it? That's the risk, JP.
This is the thing that really bothers me is when they built up to him versus Wheeler Yuta, they used the stuff about Garcia and the car crash and Wheeler Yuta using that against him as well. And I was like, this is the really interesting story, because ultimately that's where like the kind of real juice is not, can he do funny stuff occasionally? Because if he just did that like kind of offhand, then that would be amusing. And I think the problem is sometimes AEW get trapped in, this works for the live crowd, they love it, therefore it makes it a better television product. See trios matches. Like that kind of stuff always kind of like appeal. And I think the problem with Daniel Goss is this kind of idea of what makes a character. And it's like, should they be going for characters? Like, I know it's a sports entertainment thing, but like ultimately it's like, I'm not sure that's like the best way of going, really.
Agreed. Yeah, like I said, I was a little bit higher than Gareth on the match, but I do, yeah, generally agree when, like, you know, like we said at the top, the argument about ROH, this could be Daniel Garcia's playground. He's kind of slotted at the same level he is in AEW, whereas, like, if this is all ROH is going to be, he could be on top of the issue. You could be using this to go full ball, but this is the Daniel Garcia character you're going to have going forward, and he could be like one of the... I thought when they started doing these shows under Tony Khan's banner that it was going to be the playground for him and for Wheeler Yuta and for, remember, Lee Moriarty, people like that. Instead,
well, look at Yuta, look where Yuta is now, and how and that's by being presented in a very credible way, kind of, you know, despite being a smaller guy, mixing it with bigger people, you know, they've obviously given him some like good pinfall, good wins and stuff like that, but being aggressive, showing that side of the character, whereas probably you go back 2 years ago, you go, Yuta and Garcia were on a level, weren't they, really kind of coming in out of like the stuff they were doing in Beyond and things like that as well. And like now, I mean, I just see Utah on a totally level above Garcia now in terms of where their careers are. It's not to say Garcia can't go back there like in the future, but they need to fucking move away from this quick.
No, Jericho's going to get his moment before Garcia or Sammy do. I think he's going to leave the Jericho Appreciation Society before they even get a chance to finish that, whatever that story has been over the last few years. But yeah, outside of that, you know, we'll quickly wrap on the pay-per-views. We've got a Collision to chat as well. But did you have any other bigger notes, JP, on any of the other stuff? I thought it's nice to see Aussie Open winning that tag four-way. But for me, it was a tag four-way. Some fun spots in there, and yeah, some teams in there that probably shouldn't be in there compared to maybe the team that appeared on Collision this week. But that was notable. Joe Dalton Castle had absolutely nothing going on. That just felt like a match to fill out the numbers. Still, Gravity and Commander was a, you know, messy lucha opener that you kind of wanted it to be. Still don't 100% know Gravity as JP, but we might.
Andido's brother.
Oh, right. Okay. You might figure that out. That's because they figured that out by Dynamite this week, where they haven't been able to resist putting Pat the Man That Gravity Forgot against Gravity on Dynamite. Look forward to a lot of those puns on it.
Just...
He looked all right, to be fair. It was, you know, neither of them are, you know, top level lucha guys, but they're reliable to go out there and do a few fun flips to open you up and get you going. And that was the thing about the card. I thought it was very well laid out. I thought that was good. The other matches I mentioned were good. Six-man title match was all right. The Dark Order, Stu Grayson and the Righteous match, I thought, overperformed for what it was supposed to be, as far as like a big blood feud type match that I'm not even slightly invested in. Simon says here it did actually, you know, I felt the promos before it were a little bit, you know, horror B-movie stuff. The Righteous, I think, are still auditioning to be Bray Wyatt's followers. But outside of that, I thought, he did that. He did a good job.
I like the Righteous theme and him coming out and clicking his fingers. Like the dance. I do like it. Not really in ring. And he nearly, when he overshot the senton on John Silver as well, which Stu Grayson, fair play, just ran up to the top and then did, I think he did a 450 through it or something else. It was like fucking great. For that, I thought it was kind of fun. I did think to myself, it was weird seeing Dark Order in this type of a match, but maybe this is where they should be, because you can team up with Colt Cabana and it'd probably be a lot more fun, and he wouldn't get any grief for that, would you? If it's happening on even if it's if you're taping with
probably Collision. Can't do it on Saturdays.
Oh,
that's the issue.
Fuck's sakes, that old fucking chest.
We're gonna get into that.
Oh, no, we're not. No, not again as well.
But like I'll say, find a way.
It over-delivered. I mean, nothing's like, that's the thing about this show, like going through it. It's like, there's nothing that's bad. That pre-show is just like a whole lot of nothing, really. It's just like, it is an hour of dark.
Yeah. This will sell you on a pay-per-view. Yeah, I turned that off 20 minutes in when I was rewatching. Like, you know what? I just need the pay-per-view at this point.
Yeah.
But it was, I mean, we sound very negative because there's individual things to be negative. It was overall an enjoyable show. I think, if I'd have got it free with me on a club subscription, I'd probably be like, oh yeah, I had a nice time. That it was despite everything else, the lads went out there and had a good show. Like I say, there was nothing there that was, I would say, was outright bad, maybe outside the Joe and Dalton Castle, just like I say, the identity issues kind of remain with ROH. But yeah, unless there's anything else you want to mention on the ROH show, JP, should we jump over to Collision? Where we kind of have that conversation as Collision's a funny one. I'm glad we got you on, Gareth, because it's, you know, how many weeks in are we now? What, 5 or 6 weeks in? It's funny that for all the reasons I love Collision, I feel like this week's show was a really good example of one where it was like, okay, there are clearly positives and negatives to what is making Collision work. Because I was with a few times talking to ROH. ROH doesn't have a personality. I think at this point, we know Collision's got a personality. You know, Punk apparently did a locker room meeting last week where he was putting over the fact that, you know, people who normally hate Dynamite usually like Collision. Great to have you out there, Phil, as a spotlight listener.
Yes, Phil.
Big JP fan. we don't hate Dynamite, but we are more, our tastes are more fitted to Collision. And I think that's because, you know, as we've kind of said in the ROH conversation, it's that small cast of characters, isn't it? And that comes with pros and cons. Like the fact that, like, you know that each week, like you said earlier, Gareth, the show might be formatted slightly differently, But I mean, that's also a positive, the playing with the format. But you know, your main characters are going to get served. Punk's going to do something as long as he's there. Ricky Starks is getting a lot more focus than I think he's ever had. FTR are going to get something to do. Bullet Club Gold, like, their stock's gone way up just by virtue of Collision existing. Like, Jay White is off the hamster wheel now and feels like a genuine star on there. That's the positive. The negative is, by focusing on such a small group of toys, and, you know, whether it's, you know, Tony Khan not being able to persuade people to work Saturdays because you know, evil CM Punk is on the show, which, you know, to that I'd just be like, you know, you're fucking working Saturdays to most of this roster, with a couple of slim exceptions. This show summed it up, because, like, you had, yeah, you had Punk and Friends in the main event, and you had Punk and Friends in your Raw style open and promo that we can get into. But the middle of the show is just like an hour and 15 minutes of just not really much happening whatsoever. And it was like, oh, maybe there's a happy medium. Maybe, yes, we want main characters. Yes, we don't want wrestlers to disappear like happens on Dynamite. Like, the Kingo comes in and has a match of the year contender with Kenny Omega. And then the next time you see him's on Rampage 6 weeks later and they barely even mention it. And then, as JP said the other week, he's in a battle royal. Like, you know, there's follow-up and there's main characters, and that's so important. But the negative is, yeah, it's that middle of the card, isn't it? Like, I just don't think there's an excuse for having Taya Valkyrie getting that much TV time, or Will Billy Gunn retire being a key point on this show. There's got to be, between those two extremes, Gareth, like that small roster that we very much like, and that main character element, you know, Scorpio Sky probably isn't the one that's gonna save this. I think it probably does need a little bit of that juice in the middle of the card that we've learned this many weeks into it.
Yeah, and I think, like, with this cast of characters, I think one of the things that I'm probably waiting for, I'm trying to just be a little bit patient and just kind of like hold back on this, where they're saying, okay, we've been doing some small things with the likes of Miro, we've been doing small things with, say, like the likes of a Scorpio Sky, who might not necessarily be my cup of tea, or who I, you know, absolutely, want to be seen involved in there. But it appears like there's at least a thought process going into these recurring cast of characters that appears to be something that's laid down, that's, they've thought about 2 months, they've thought about 3 months in advance, kind of thing. They know that, okay, this is a promo that's leading to a squash that's then leading to having a match the following week, and then the following week. And I think there's almost that kind of, like, I almost feel like I'm having to sort of like reset my own mind to seeing wrestling booked in a different way, because I feel like Dynamite's got very WWFE and or WWE in the way that that's been booked of late, and I feel like this is, because it's fresh, there is always that danger that you sort of like want stuff to be a bit more immediate, or you want stuff to be a bit more, you know, things to be happening, whereas this does feel like it is something that's a bit more considered, it's a bit more slower process. There is that thought process to actually developing and shaping and rounding people properly by, you know, giving them the vignettes and the promos and the squashes and things like that. But equally, on the, like, this, the same with you, really, Benno, while you're saying that about the mid-card, there's parts of that that with the main event that I have problems with, because, like, that main event this week was, you know, I don't know how it went, but essentially it was a half-hour match, half-hour segment or something like that, and it just felt largely just inconsequential, and I don't know how much time I've got in my life to be watching half an hour match again when there's been 2 weeks ago a six-man tag or something like that that kind of felt the same, probably two weeks before that another six-man tag or a tag that sort of again felt the same. These things that you've got guys out there that I love, like CM Punk and things like that, but you're watching it and it's like, what is this? What is the reason for this right now? And why does this need to be 30 minutes? Why is this should be 15 minutes kind of thing, this? And it's just making it just feel a bit labored and a bit too lengthy. And, or you know, God, no one's going to like advocate for kind of like slow, detailed wrestling and things like that more than me, but it's got to have some juice or purpose or something about it, really. And I just feel like this is, it just feels a bit, I don't know, a bit light and a bit cold, and especially when you're going into a match like that that has followed up mid-card matches like this that have just felt like,
yeah,
what the fuck, why, like this, like I thought that was a it felt like a painful 2 hours this week. The most fun I had was watching Miro, and how long was that? 4 minute match, maybe 3 minute match or something like that. But that was absolutely the most enjoyable part of the program for me. For me, this week, everything just felt laboured a bit.
I get your point, because it's like, for me, it's like, I feel the same way as you. It's like, I don't want to be ungrateful either, because I want to be like, no, but like, you know, we could play Dynamite, and the fact that things aren't followed up on, and the fact that, you know, Will Ospreay debuts, and then it's to the back. We've got 8 more debuts to come this show, and then by the end of the show, you've forgotten it happened. Like, or like we were saying about the other week, about Dynamite, like about how a lot of weeks you get to the main event, you forget it's even the main event. You don't have that problem with the Collision, because it is smaller scale, slower built. They're making it, you know, clear what the main event is. But there is, yeah, there's a line. And I think this was definitely the weakest Collision so far. I think the best one was a couple of weeks ago, or to be honest, even last week with the hour match, which I thought was a really interesting experiment. And then, you know, you still had your Punk main event segment. So that was a nice little way of doing things. I think this week's did expose it a little bit in that, like you say, yeah, I felt like going in, and this is the problem, like, I am, you know, I know you, we joke about, like, we get you on the podcast, Gareth, and you've got 9 hours of wrestling to catch up on. You know, that's not me, because I'm the knobhead who sits up and watches all these things live. But all it took this week was for me to have a wedding to go to on Saturday, and I was behind on the ROH pay-per-view already because I had plans on Friday, and then I had to catch up with Collision, and then, like, I barely got the ROH pay-per-view in, and it's like, Tony Khan is putting such a squeeze on all of our time that it does, you know, even for me, you know, someone who's going to podcast about this every week, it's like, you need to give me something, you need to give me a hook, because going into Collision this week, they had nothing announced. It was that shit mid-card. Like, you barely even knew Punk was going to be on the show. Like, when the number comes out tomorrow, I'm going to be interested in what it is, because they, like, say that was the other discussion point here, that they went the full Monday Night Raw route in that, like, it was the trail of promos, like, someone comes out and then they get interrupted, and then they get interrupted, and then they get interrupted. Why don't we have a tag team match player? So it's more SmackDown than Raw. Like, but like, that's literally what they did this week, and I find it interesting them playing with that format and doing it. But I don't want to see that every week either, because I just don't think, you know, WWE have tried to prove, and they've beaten that into the ground. And, you know, you need a big advertised main event, I think, going into the show, and the show needs to feel like it has stakes. And it did, because it was just lads interrupting each other. It felt like, oh, for a laugh, let's have a tag match. And yeah, there's got to be a balance there, hasn't there? Of like, yeah, I'm enjoying the small scale story being told. I don't know about how your thoughts are on Ricky Starks these days, but I think it's brought, like you say, that it's the same for the Scorpio Sky thing. I think Scorpio Sky is way down my list of guys that I'd want to see on TV getting all that TV time, but at least they're trying. And I think Ricky Starks is in that point where, like, this TLC they're giving him and giving him that heel edge is probably helping him a lot. And, you know, telling this longer term story is built for, you know, people like us and for people with maybe our patience. But I think if you're going to do that, you also need to surround it with, you know, yeah, more urgent things. And that was the thing about this week's show. It was just lacking urgency.
And with the Ricky Starks, obviously I've been like pretty vocal about Ricky Starks in the past. You know, I'd say what they're doing with him in the last fortnight is the most interesting thing that I've seen them do with Ricky Starks in the entire time that, you know, that they've had him. What I will say is if he comes out of this feud and he is not a main event player, then I personally all feel like I'm fucking totally vindicated and totally correct, you know, because I've never said Ricky Stark is shit. I've just said he's not this top guy that people like had him, like, you know, the way people were talking about him 12 months ago, 18 months ago, and things like, is this main event in waiting, like, is the new Rock and all this stuff, and just utter rubbish that, you know, people come out with, you know, closer to Ken Kennedy, I think, on that point. But, like, I just think that, like, he's had pushes with belts. He's had where, okay, let him do commentary every week where he added nothing and things like that. He's had, you know, he's been involved in big storylines and things. Here, he's had a win over CM Punk. Like, you know, is here where he's been put into, like, big promos, you know. I was pissing myself at the pyro and things like that. I was laughing at, you know, for a heel and things in that situation. It was hilarious, like, to see that much, you know, pyro and things like that, you know. Yeah, I was thinking, just, you know, keep this, hand this up. I don't know if, like, I don't know how much I was down with him with his whole like his Prada thing and his Louis Vuitton and all that. I thought that was a bit shit myself, to be honest.
But big amongst the rappers, those bags, mate. It's the biggest thing going right now. Handbags. Don't ask me why. It's a whole thing.
but I think this is the best for me. This is the best vehicle he's had to be interesting and actually kick on to the next level. So I'm at least interested to see where it goes, which is a step up for me. But to come back to your point about, like, you know, watching it, and you normally been somebody sat up there watching live, I don't know why anybody in America who can watch this at a reasonable time on a Saturday night would be their thing they choose to do on a Saturday night. Like, yeah. Kind of thing. It's like, unless you're just like, you're just in and you've literally got nothing, why wouldn't you just like watch this like tomorrow on like on DVR or something like that? Why do you need to watch this live? What is compelling about this that means you've been waiting? Oh, can't wait for Collision this week because X, Y, or Z. I think they've done that maybe once with Punk and Joe. Maybe there might have been another instance where there was that, but it's not. It's not something that you have to watch live, not at all. There's nothing compelling about it. And that's where it then flies in the face of where you're getting into, well, what's the purpose of it? Is it TV deals and money and extra revenue and things like that? Well, if it's the ratings continue in the vein that they're going, then you just go again. Actually, what you might end up doing is diluting the overall perception of AEW within the TV industry, because it's not delivering the numbers when they've given it the opportunities to do so on different nights and things, and especially in a time period when, you know, ringing the bell, year on year, Dynamite numbers are down double digit again, and for the second successive year, down double digit on, you know, in quarter three as well. They're not going in the right direction either, so I don't know.
Yeah,
needs more compelling is what I would say.
But that's the gamble here, isn't it? Like, I think by Collision just existing, if we talk about our like time, like being stretched to get it in as podcasters, like it's gonna stretch people's time, and there's gonna, you know, it's hard to look at, like, you know, we're not necessarily talking the demo here, just maybe the overall. It's hard to look at that Dynamite numbers the last few weeks, blood and guts aside, and go, the reason is Collision exists. But it's gonna take a bite out of it. That's, I think you've almost got to accept that going in, that by adding more TV and expecting people to spend more time with us, people are gonna have to start making choices. Because yeah, as a podcaster who's, you know, I the type who will stay up late and watch these shows, I'm, you know, this many weeks in going, I don't think I can do this on Wednesday and Saturday every week. You know, you're gonna have that attrition, aren't you? It's gonna make a problem, like you say, with the year on year numbers stand out even more. It's gonna make that even worse, isn't it? It's gonna spread those spin.
Last Sunday, I hadn't watched Dynamite, which meant that, you know, I'm gonna watch it in order. So I'm gonna watch Dynamite, then Rampage, then Collision. But because I hadn't watched Dynamite up to that point, that meant that I was like, fuck, I've got Dynamite to watch, I've got Rampage to watch, I've got Collision to watch. I think I said it in our chat, and Connor goes, oh, it was Battle of the Belts as well. And I was like, fucking hell. Like, I was like, all I've done is not watch it for 2 days, like Thursday night or Friday, or three days. And suddenly I'm 6 hours behind. I was like, where the fuck am I going to get 6 hours from to watch all this? Although, I mean, I did, because like Sarah went out or something like that on the Sunday night or the Monday, you know, so I suddenly had a random block of time to get back up to speed. But you're just like, fucking hell, you don't want to get people into a world where suddenly they're like, oh shit, I'm 12 hours behind. I'm out of the loop. I'm going to stop watching it. I'll just watch the big pay-per-views or I'll pick and choose matches, because that's when your audience just goes, doesn't it?
Although, you got to say, the counter is, you know, Rampage has miraculously been doing quite good the last few weeks. Battle of the Belts did great. Like, the Collision lead-in really helped them. They're going to be thinking, oh, you know what we could do? Maybe not third hour, but, you know, the hour after Dynamite could be where, you know, Rampage ends up. The hour after Collision, there could be a Battle of the Belts equivalent. This might not be the end of it, you know? There might be, like, some kind of argument. Because I think the positive of the you know, to pull it back around, of the Collision way they do things and the slow build of it, is that those Collision numbers, while small overall, it's a pattern more used to what you'd expect from wrestling broadcasting. Like, if you look at like the Dynamite numbers, and I'll argue this, and year on year is your gimmick, Gareth. My gimmick is that last quarter wasn't always Death. It was pretty much since they moved over to TBS. But before that didn't always happen. But I think that's maybe, a part of the style of the way Dynamite is, that the numbers are up and down and people tune out for the main events, you know, in numbers that you maybe shouldn't expect. The positive of Collision, by doing things slowly and taking things back to that level, the numbers actually seem to increase through the show, or they peak at the right, they peak, you know, when there's that big FTR tag in the middle, and then they peak again for the main event because you've spent the entire show building it. So there's something to be said for that going back to basics, I would say, JP. Again, even though we're talking smaller numbers overall, there's something there. There's a logic to it. It's just the weight of everything else.
They're big on, and it did feel very raw for the opening. Like this week, obviously, with the kind of dueling promo stuff, to then lead to a tag team match later on in the night. I mean, but at least there's a show, at least there's a hook throughout the show. I think the issue is, it is about making people in order for it to kind of like structurally work. And I think there's a lot of stuff that I kind of generally like about it. But you're still just waiting for things to happen. We haven't had like the kind of big angle or anything else. We've still had a sanitized version of CM Punk. And I think that's the other thing as well, is if this is Punk off the leash, I think then you get people talking about Collision and then you create something there. But he isn't. Like, that's the thing. He's a baby face who's being booed whilst hamming it up as well. And slagging off New Jersey and the rest of it. It's still
is the heel.
We've not had the kickoff.
That's the long term.
And I don't think Ricky Starks is going to be booed at all during any of this. I think this whole thing ends up elevating him more as a face than I think anything else. I don't see any like him being a top line heel. He's just deciding like he's going to cut. It's like he's just cutting some corners for the time being. And don't we all? It's like non declaration of earnings. It's like we all.
Please don't listen, Mr. Taxman. But on that note, yeah, anything more to say on the main event or the contents of the show itself, Gareth? I think I enjoyed the main event a bit more than you. We're big Christian fans, so getting to see him in his turtleneck interact with CM Punk was enough for me to get enjoyment out of that. I want to see those lads of a singles match now. But outside of that, I don't have like a lot to say. Like I say, Raw opening promo, fine, just don't do it every week. FTR promo was fine. And then there was just a little bit of shit on the show. And yeah, don't really have many individual segment takes this week.
Nick Kamara is big.
Yeah. But it was the reaction to Miro was great. We've always said he's got that fucking just that overness. He's got that main event like feel to him. If that's something they can harness, then that's something that could be compelling. Seeing him just get like a proper fucking run for the first time in God knows ever, you know, like how long, because the crowd were that was one of the biggest pops like of the night, and that's, you know, on a thing where you've got bells and whistles behind you know Ricky Starks and Punk and all stuff going on there, that the crowd really fucking popped for Miro there. But I think you know, again, going over old ground, you said it plenty over the last couple of weeks, but it just, you know, I think just seeing the development kind of in the exposure that Jay White's had on this, I think, is something as well that I just kind of like concur with as well, really, sort of thing. I think is just really just getting that opportunity, just kind of like a bit of time and a bit of freedom to just sort of like step outside and show his character and show his charisma and things like that as well. And it's definitely something that's coming through without it being like slapped in the face with it, you know, and it just been like, you know, turned up to ridiculous levels. It feels organic in some way, like it's an organic way for somebody who's obviously been a massive established star in Japan to sort of bleed into the American audience for people who might not necessarily be as familiar with him, by letting him just kind of showcase a bit of what's good about him and things like that. I still don't get why the Gun Club would want to hang around with two lads who were a tag team who were going for the tag belts themselves in Jay White and Juice Robinson, when, hang about, you were the champions last, kind of thing. Why do you want to support these lads in going for the belts that you've just had? But anyway, that's by the by. That's where the logic goes out the window.
That's your AEW. Well, we can talk more on like the FTR and Adam Cole and MJF thing. I presume that's setting up, you know, MJF coming into the Punkverse maybe, and we're gonna get going on some All In stuff, I kind of hope. But yeah, I didn't really have any takes outside of that, JP. Like I said, the one thing I would say, I feel like Jay and Juice should have gone over a lot quicker. Over those two ROH jobbers, I feel like 10 minutes purely because they needed to fill the TV time. I think for me, it was either I've got no problem with them coming in and doing a job, but like do a job in like 3 minutes. You shouldn't be going back and forth with Juice and Jay. And if you are going to go back and forth, put a better team in there, then put someone in there that you might actually see a future in. And there are three or four different options on that that ROH show that are probably better than the lads they went with.
Yeah, that's it. It's still, this show should be padded out. It should be tight as fuck in its production. Like, it needs to have everything meaning something, because the most part, I think there is like Gareth mentioned with Amira, where you can put them in and you're finally doing interesting stuff. I don't know if we're ever going to get any kind of proper, I don't know if we're ever going to see Malachi Black in the singles match.
Remember the open challenge?
Why isn't Malachi Black? Why wasn't he in a beard versus mask match with Andrade? That's all I was like, he's shaved his beard off. Like, he's had that beard for years. I was like, fucking old school wrestling would have made something of that beard, kind of, you know.
You know who would have sorted that? Zelina Vega, Andrade's manager, and having a word. And lads, come on, this is booking 101.
Well, on that note, we should switch over to Dynamite. Obviously, last month or so, man, JP's Dynamite thoughts have been living on the weekend show with the launch of Collision and everything else going on. But yeah, Gareth, we haven't heard your Dynamite thoughts. Ours are on YouTube, youtube.com/grapple, if you want the full blood and guts takes from me and JP. But we're higher on that this week. How are you feeling on before we get to the big match itself? MJF and Adam Cole, is that our Wembley main event, mate, that they're building up for us?
I'm enjoying this mid-card tag. It's I think it's great how these two mid-carders have put them together, and they've managed to just draw a bit of personality and connection out of them. I think it's like, God forbid you'd want to put your world title, your world champion in this. They wouldn't do a thing like that, would they? Like, absolutely not. But no, it's nice to, they're almost like the New Age Outlaws again or something like that, where you've just put two lads together and they've got a little gimmick going over the crowd with the double clothesline that they're fans are shouting in, not just their matches, but everybody else's matches now as well. So are they over, or are is the move over, or is the shout over? I don't know. But I don't know. This is a conundrum to me, this one, because like, I have to kind of like take a step back with it and be like, serious, you know, serious analytical mind, Gareth, looking at your world champion and thinking, why is your world champion doing this and in this feud and in this situation? Why is your world title been presented in this particular way and things like that? And then if I kind of take that out of the window, am I entertained? Yes, I am. Like, kind of thing. And like,
JP's just dropped out the call, by the way, for the audio listeners. Shall we mark out about it now and tell everyone how much we loved it? I feel guilty when I enjoy some of these segments, because I agree intellectually.
it's like, I literally, like, I was like, because I was taking notes on this when I was watching it anyway, just on the odd chance that I might have ended up like doing the show today. But like, I was thinking, as I was writing it, I was just thinking, like, I just had like Jamesy sat behind me over my shoulder, and I was just thinking, oh God, am I going to lose some Jamesy credibility points here or something like that? Because I was just like, I am entertained. And like, was I sat there watching that match, desperately waiting for them to hit a double clothesline? Oh, yes, I was, kind of thing. And I was like waiting for that moment and the crowd pop and things like that. And like, I think at the end of the day,
the answer is just, it shouldn't be for the world title.
Base level, it's entertaining as fuck. It's the great chemistry between them, doing the different things, the little vignettes and stuff like that that they've done. So they've been a bit hit and missing part, but in the majority, I've enjoyed what they've done. And it's had like a laugh out of me, and it's felt like a change of pace and something that's a bit more different and positive and just stands out on the show and things like that. But yeah, this is your world heavyweight champion, like, doing this, like, that's where I have my worries. And this is where I think, not only do you make the belt feel less than, it kind of makes MGF feel a bit less than as well, really, in that he doesn't feel like a, you know, top line main event heel. He feels like a mid-carder in a growing, evolving, organically developing tag team, which is just not what you'd want him to be, would you?
Do you really think the headline and all in with it? Like, that feels like what's happening, doesn't it?
It has to be. Well,
yeah, what else? Unless it's Punk MJF and they need to get moving if that's the match. But I keep thinking that with anything Punk related, I'm like, they're probably going to save for Chicago, which is not the right attitude. Like, but, you know, that's kind of our feel of going with it. But yeah, I've been saying that, like you said, we'll put our grown-up head on, because I've been kind of making this argument with JP. Not that I disagree, you know, on the world title points, but if we are going to put our grown-up head on, you know, it's doing great quarter hours. It's the best T-shirt they've sold all year. You know, that might sound cringeworthy to some, but that's an indication of success. And if it did happen at Wembley, you know there'd be 80,000 people who probably aren't us marking out massively for it, you know? I suppose it'd be, you know, the comedy element would be gone then, wouldn't it? It'd be more of a straight-up singles match, but I think people would be invested in it. Yeah. Although saying that, now that I've said it, I might be working myself to the shoot. Maybe they will just stay together and they do a tag match at Wembley. You know what our fans are like. They'll fucking eat that shit up, won't they?
Yeah.
The whole double clothesline stuff and like that. Like, that might actually be the call they go with. But again, the problem is your world title is then not being defended on your biggest show of the year. So you probably can't.
Yeah.
Or at least we think is the biggest show of the year. I don't know if Tony Khan thinks that.
That's it. At the end of the day, you've just got to take a step back and look at it and go, like, it is the most entertaining thing across all of their TV at the moment. And it's probably the most entertaining thing that they've done for a few months, largely, when it comes to kind of from a... And I feel wrong saying that. Like, I feel dirty saying that. Like, but it's just... I don't know. It's a sad fact, you know, almost. But, you know, I can't see anything else being the main event at Wembley. I was going to say they haven't got enough time, but that doesn't bother Big Tony. He'll can just decide something on the Thursday, won't he, and submit be the main event on the day. But like, this looks like the direction it's going. The crowd will be fucking right behind it because they've been entertaining the crowd. And who are we to say that a belt should mean something? On mute, mate.
Oh, fuck. I was going to say, like, I've been seeing that conversation all week, people being like, oh, he'll thread the needle perfectly, Tony. He'll find a way to do All In and All Out. No, he won't. He'll book All In, and then, like, the week between All In and All Out, 7 of the 8 matches will get announced. He'll figure it out.
Ladder match, you know. Casino Battle Royal on the Tuesday, and that'll be the main event for the next show or something.
Yeah, in a word. That I'm really worried about All In, because I did think to myself, and it's going to sound awful, because I just thought to myself, like, can we stop pandering to fucking Chicago, please? Having announcements for them before All In. Fuck off. It's a stadium show. They have it every fucking week. They have as much AEW as you can shake a big bloody stick at. Honestly, they should be fucking grateful they're still getting paid.
Not that we're better at all. But any thoughts at all on we got the biggest, we're going to have the biggest, best AEW show ever, so we win regardless. We'll make it that way if the card isn't the case. He's got to put his eggs in that All In basket. But maybe we'll find out more on Dynamite this week. But speaking more of last week, Gareth, thoughts on Blood and Guts overall? Again, I feel like this show should be like, maybe the title be negative but nuanced. We've been very negative, but I think we've been quite nuanced and grown up in our takes, you know, admitting when things aren't for us, you know, explaining why we might be a bit negative, even on things we love, like, you know, the Punkverse, which I'm, you know, still a full-on subscriber to, even if I can see the negatives there. Blood and Guts was something me, JP, I think compared to most podcasts, were quite negative on there when we talked on the weekend show. I think we kind of just came to the assumption, JP, that this match style of 2023 just isn't for us, or maybe just isn't for AEW, because for me, I feel like it's three I've been underwhelmed by so far. And I think you were in league with us with the first two. Gareth, did the third one change your mind at all? There wasn't a bump onto a mattress, at least, you know? You didn't do a Mick Foley in his garden from 1970, whatever it was. So at least we had that. What were your thoughts on the actual Blood and Guts match?
I mean, I've gone... Again, I haven't listened to your weekend show on Friday yet, so I don't know where you're at, but I've gone like 3.5 on it. Like, I just... which I was a bit like... Is that the same? Good. Maybe we just got groupthink at this point, kind of thing, because I was a bit...
We need Matty here to throw something in the mix. He'd either go 1 or 5, nowhere in between.
It was just... it was a very long match involving a lot of people, involving a lot of gimmicks, that, you know, weapons and things like that, that largely felt like it didn't necessarily kind of go anywhere, and a lot of what happened in the match just felt a bit so what really. And I don't know, it was like, I think with the Blackpool Combat Club team, you know, obviously all coming out with like the different weapons and things like that, it's just, oh, here we go, he's another fork, he's another chair, you know, like kind of thing. And then as things came out during the match, it was, oh, he's a bed of nails, he's like, it was just getting to me into that territory where I'll just always say, like with death matches, a bit of like, oh, he's some shit just because kind of thing. And I think probably obviously they were hindered to some degree by the way that this match was like put together, and there's certain people like interjected into it where it was just this match is happening because it's time for blood and guts, you know, the major criticism mm-hmm. of WWF over the years with things like Hell in the Cell and things like things like that just becoming a gimmick at a certain time period. And it did just sort of feel a bit like this. It was like, oh, well, we've booked this as blood and guts now, and these lads are joined in the match. It was almost been a bit better if they'd have gone, no, actually, this is going to have to be like a 3-on-3 or something like that, really. And just like the people who've actually been like largely embroiled in this feud are just going to go out there and just feel like they've got a bit more heat and a bit more kind of, you know, reason to kick the shit out of each other in it. You know, this just felt a bit, I don't know, just for something was just lacking. I can't quite put my finger on it. It just felt like there should have been more needle, more hate. And then when you're then introducing those kind of weapons in it and then feeling like spots rather than feeling like hatreds kind of thing and stuff, it just, there was almost this like perfect imbalance of so many different variables, from the number of the people in the match to the additional people in the match to the weapons that we used to the length of the match to like everything about it just didn't feel like it just fit together like properly for me. And I think I don't know, there was just like little things, like people were just getting like forked in the head and just all stuff happening, and then no one's bleeding, and then you look around and John Mox is bleeding first because of course he is, despite the fact that all these people have been taking forks to the head and stuff. It just, little things like that were just like throwing me off, like, you know, completely. And I don't know, there was a couple, like, so the stuff on the top of the cage was a bit lame, and like the, you know, there was a couple of good, like the pack spot off the top of the, where he dropped, the, you know, through the table was quite, was like quite a cool spot, quite cool spot kind of thing. But like, was that enough to kind of like glue all of these other parts together? And like, not for me really. And that's, yeah, I don't know. It was just there. And this shouldn't be a type of match that is just there.
Yeah,
does that make any sense? I don't know. I feel like I'm rambling a bit there. Kind of.
Basically, what we said in another week. I think blood and guts in 2023. And in my head, I want them to go full War Games. The door never opens. It's just, you know, I would defend Moxley. I felt like when he came in, it added that, like, okay, cool, he's just going to try and hurt people. Whereas before it was just too cutesy and there were too many of those spots. But I agree with, like, the broad strokes of your criticism. For me, it was the ending that killed it for me. It was like, they, for all the TV time they had, which seems to be a lesson they learned from Collision, the actual walkout moments when they happened to the finish, which should have been this big dramatic moment, felt like they went over in about 60 seconds. And it just didn't have like that, you know, that big oomph ending that you kind of wanted to punctuate that this was such a violent match. And the babyface had to go up. The camera basically missed Moxley even, you know, submitting on behalf of his team. I don't think I even knew that happened until like an hour after the show when I saw somebody mention it on Twitter. That was more the issue for me. It was that, it was the rushed nature of it. And it was just the, like I say, it opening that door, you lose me immediately. And to do it just so fucking whichever Jackson can do his stupid Northern Lights spot and then drop some fucking tacks down when you could have just kept the fucking door shut, you know, like just do one match that's like that sticks to what the rules are supposed to be for War Games. Maybe it's just that I'm a stickler for that. So it was almost like it was a lot of the same things you said, Gareth, but all of those different things were, but it was that same conclusion of, I still enjoyed enough of it to give it 3.5 stars. So it's not like I'm saying this was a 2-star shit ever. But it was overall underwhelming for what this match, you know, could be and should be and hasn't been over the 3 years AEW have been doing it.
They've forgotten about the idea of it being has to be a really big blood feud, and it already finished and passed by that point. There we go. Yeah. You were talking about
I must forgive them on this one, because this one kind of was. I almost feel like this feud was the one way you'd do it, but yeah, maybe it is. It's a bit late, isn't it? It's a bit like, okay, we've seen this now, this feud's been done.
You were going to talk about lads sticking forks in lads' heads, which feels like a perfect segue to something else, but is it a bit too early to dive into that?
Maybe a bit early, We'll talk about that later. Yeah. But there you go. Any other thoughts on Dynamite at all, Gareth, you wanted to mention?
Yeah, Jungle Boy's shit, and I was right.
That's why I wanted to let you have that. You were going to say that. The smirky face on his pin didn't turn you around, mate. I think that's going to be a Gareth was right victory lap that you can probably already take today, mate. The music didn't move you.
Fucking hell. Like, what the fuck was that? Like, unbelievable. And like, the thing that was perfect for me was like, he was going at a lad, like a kid in the front row, and he couldn't even scare the kid in the front row. And I was thinking, like, you know, come on, like the kid was just like laughing at him, sort of thing. And he was just like, come on, heel Jack, like, go, like, shows your chops, like, terrify this child. Like, no, just laughing at him. And like, even like throughout this match, sorry, I'll do this for as long as you want every week on Jungle Boy, if you want, as a heel. But just even little things like he did a finger poke in the eye and stuff, and it was just, the timing of it was just all wrong and stuff, and the way that he showed to the crowd when he did it and things like it was just wrong, and it was just delivered just poorly, and it was like the sort of thing that if I saw an indie show in front of 50 people and the heel did it, I'd be like, oh, that was shit kind of thing. Never mind being some like one of the four pillars now being pushed as a big heel on the, you know, premier TV show, you know, in the opening match, you know, just there's a lot of like just where he just did a little just like heelish stuff that were like, I think there was like faking the flashy moves and stuff. It all just came across as so low rent. It was almost like somebody had like handed him a book of like, right, Jack, read this. This is how you become a heel. These are the things that you have to do. Like, right, you've got your leather kecks on and you come down and you like go at a kid in the crowd. And then it was like, oh, finger poke in the eye. And then like pretend you're going to do old moves and then you don't do them and stuff like that. And all of it just like felt like it just came across just like lame and a bit shit, really, you know. And he felt like to me like a Disco Inferno level heel on Nitro back in the day, as opposed to feeling like he's one of your top guys for the future, getting that big heel push where you can really, oh, you can lean into it now, Jack, like go on, you know, get like do your best work, you know, like everybody loves being a heel, like, you know, go out there. And he just looks like fish out of water. Best thing was that T-bone suplex by Hook off the apron. That was fucking beautiful. But nearly dumped him out of the gimmick for good, that one. But come back. See, for more like Jungle Boy Love. Same time, same place, same channel.
See, I like the music, so it gives me an excuse to use A plus as Enjoy Yourself, possibly as the outro, which also samples Beethoven's Fifth. That just didn't work for him, the whole burying himself and all of that. I find you someone who believes in Jungle Boy and Sammy Guevara more than Tony Khan, because he's going to keep trying. Like, he's in that same group as Sammy Guevara. And I think what we found, though, it's reductive, but I don't think he's not one of those people who's, you know, it's sink or swim, throw him out on his own and he'll figure it out. Don't think he's going to. He needs that big brother. He probably needs to be back with Christian. He probably needs to be with, yeah, like some kind of heel act, or Don Callis, I think you brought up, JP. Because this isn't going to work, is it, on its own? I think it's early to call it, but you're right to do this victory like that. We'll just get you to send us a voicemail once a week. You can just do 5 minutes on what Jungle Boy did wrong this week.
I tell you, he needs to be with Luther on Dark. That's who he needs to be with.
Fucking
Put him under a mask.
Man, that's brutal.
Lord Pentico. He can go under a mask with Sir Pentico.
Well, while we're keeping the positivity train going, I think that's AEW, I think, for the week. Like I say, more thoughts on Dynamite over on the YouTube as well. But you know, we should talk about being positive, JP, before we get back to bloody forks and that type of thing. G1 is still going on, apparently. There's only been one show since we recorded Weekend Show on Friday, and I think most people out there will have skipped it because I just get the feeling everyone's given up already. Shingo and Ishii had a Shingo and Ishii match today yesterday, so there was at least that. It's probably the lower end of what they do, 3.75 to maybe 4-star, but there was a dead crowd. There was a horrendous show around it. Just a who's who of, you know, the problematic boys in this tournament. If it's not like one of the Bullet Club lads coming out, it's one of the Tongans coming out, or if it's one of the Aussies coming out, it's a who's who of mid this G1 this year we've found. And I think even picking and choosing doesn't do it when you have a day like Sunday. Maybe Eddie Kingston and Hanare I could make a half attempt to feel enthused about. But yeah, if anyone's already at the skipping point, which it sounds like I think you already are, Gareth, maybe for the whole tournament at this point, I can't blame them. Like even Ian Hamilton was saying, wasn't he, in our Discord, like as someone who's writing these reviews. If he wasn't writing reviews, I think he'd be out on the G1. And it's sad to say, because I really willing myself into it. I want it to be that thing I throw on the telly while, even if it's just, it's become background viewing while I'm working, you know, for Hook or by Crook. But even then, it's like, it's, you know, I'm paying more attention to, as I should be, my work spreadsheets than I am whatever the fuck Tamatonga and Mikey Nichols are doing in the ring. It's just, yeah, my enthusiasm has been dampened so quickly, and I'm so sad about it. I don't know. I mean, me and JP have already been moaning about it. Have you saw any of it, Gareth? Are you enthused to see any of it? Like, this felt like the interview back, you know? Crowds are there. You know, got Eddie Kingston's in there. That made me excited. You know, fresh kind of layout. But then we found out that layout also comes with a heavy dose and a fat, unfortunately.
Yeah, I've checked out on day one. I thought, right, this is, I'm going to watch. I actually thought I'm going to watch all of the G1. That was something that I was like, I'm just going to do it. Just going to give New Japan a big chance here and just get back into it. And like that for day one, I think there was like Yoshihashi, El Phantasmo, shit, Chase Owens, Gabriel Kidd, like that. Where it was, there was Tangalo Akenta that was fucking awful. And then like I got to the Red Narita show Umino match, and like I really, really enjoyed that. Apart from some crap striking early on, like I really enjoyed the actual grappling and things that was in that match, and like I enjoyed the story that they were telling. I enjoyed that it went to the time limit draw, and that kind of like really, like I left that match just feeling like dead enthused of like, oh, I'm want to follow these two and the way this goes and things like that from here. And then I watched that Akan match and I was like, yeah. And then I didn't get around to watching anything after that because I had to go and, you know, put the bins out or something like that. I just never got back around to it. I think I heard you used to slate day two. And then I was just like, well, I'm not watching day two. And then like you were looking at things and looking at the groups and that. And I was just like, there's just so many wrestlers here. There's so much dross here in the G1, all these different people who's in there. And like, it used to be like, this is the elite kind of thing. And it would be like, okay, there might be two lads in the tournament that you're like, oh, Yujiro's in it or someone like that. And you're like, ah, but it doesn't matter because the vast majority of them is the absolute top end here. Whereas I'm looking at this now and I'm like, I'm struggling to see, you know, there's maybe, you know, the elite is the minor in this as opposed to the majority kind of thing. So it's almost like the top lads have replaced the bottom lads in the way that it's gone around. And there is that sort of almost a bit of feeling of less is more. And actually, rather than this being the pinnacle, the number one wrestling tournament in the world, now it just feels like, I don't know, it feels like some gigantic tournament that's just full of absolutely loads of people putting on matches that you look at the card and you go, well, I'm not bothered about that. Am I going to tune in to watch that one match that might be a 4-star match? Nah, I've seen Shingo and have 4-star matches before. I've seen Ishii have 4-star matches before. What's the point? Kind of thing, you know. So unless somebody says to me like, oh, like these two people who you wouldn't expect had an absolute banger and it was a first time matchup or something like that, there's no reason for me to tune in. Sorry, am I right? Negative cunt, aren't I? Everything I've talked about tonight.
It's one of them. we're not all losing the will to live, listeners. It's just, it's been a bad week. It was the same on the weekend show, wasn't it, JP? Because we've been quite, I think for us, quite positive lately, because I'm a full-on collider and we've been positive about that. But Dave, that was a bad week. ROH was a good show, but you can't help but talk about the negatives there. And Dynamite has its issues. And yeah, the G1 is the thing that's killing us off. Because I said to JP, Gareth, like, you nailed it there, and that, like, it used to be like two guys maybe, or three guys in the G1 once you add in, you know, a Farley or whatever, that'd be the ones you skip. Like, how spoiled were we? I said to JP, like, 4 or 5 years ago, people I was complaining about were Yoshihashi and Goto. Like, they're like top five now, like, you know. And that's because, you know, I think Yoshihashi's gotten better, and Goto was never as bad as maybe I felt he was for a short period. But that's how spoiled we were. I was picking fights with those lads because it was elite outside of that, you know. Again, you know, a Tongan or two aside, but now you've got like 12 Tongans, Chase Owens, and a load of mid Aussie guys in there. It's just, it's too much, isn't it? Like, how could you possibly be invested? It's a real killer this year, unfortunately. And yeah, Connor's spreadsheet is the only thing keeping me going. The pickums we've got going there, and that's it, really. That's the most I enjoy the G1.
Well, with Connor mentioning like that, the spreadsheet being his GRAPPL replacement there, as I think back to that first GRAPPL 100, when like the first year of the app, I think something like 18% of the top 100 matches that year came from the G1. Like, how many matches have you heard? How many people? How many, like, I've heard nobody talking about any of these matches has been like something
that you generous should be like, one or two
going out your way to, like, that's going to be like top stuff that people are going to be talking about. Like, it used to be the best of the best.
We're raving about 4-star matches rather than 4.5-star matches, aren't we, JP? That's the thing.
That's it. It's like we've accepted the downturn because of the last couple of years, but there's a few things going on here. There's the one of, okay, we'll move it up to 4 blocks. That'll help reduce the schedule. But in fact, what's happened is, it just sort of means those group stages don't mean anything. It's like an expanded World Cup. That'll be the analogy we'll be going for here. There's a lot of dross in this. It doesn't make that exciting. So really the only main excitement, and you think the match quality is going to come in the quarterfinals. Then you're tied in with some of the, like, booking tropes. So the 20-minute time limit thing, that's a good thing. Like, you think, oh, generally it'll shorten up, it'll tighten up the shows, it'll give a bit of excitement for some of those longer matches. And in fact, what we found is there's going to be matches that kind of kill time to go up to the 20 minutes. And there's some that needlessly go close to that. And others are just going to be used as draws between three sets of guys, which effectively rules them out. So it's like a booking trope. It's like a screenwriter's trope. And Gedo's still doing that type of stuff. And that's somewhat of an issue, I think, for me. I look at, like, where the real interest lies, what comes in the great matches. If you look at the other days, there's only like one match or two matches top out of the 9, because there's so much dross in there that you're looking for. So it's Sonada versus Kiyomiya, and I'm terrified. I'm thinking it's Sonada. It could easily end up becoming a fucking bore fest. It should be the kind of thing that I think is a bit more lively. There also should be a moratorium of, if you're in a tag team, and that's primarily where you compete, you're not in this tournament. It's for single wrestlers only. And I think that's, like, that's a thing with it. Having TMDK in there, it's just they're there to play weird spoiler and then lose the rest of their matches. So fundamentally, it's pointless having them in there. They don't gain anything from this. They're just there to fill a very specific role. Whereas you could shorten down the tournament, have 4 blocks of 5, 4 blocks of 6, but everyone wants a fucking piece of it. Then if someone has a bad tournament, you've got storylines that come out of it. What's the storyline other than Shane Haste wore an orange suit? We're not going to remember anything in the matches. That's the thing that gets remembered. And this is meant to be, as Gareth said, the elite wrestling tournament in the world. That was its bread and butter. It's why people watch it like that. It's fucking good every year. And now it's just like, it feels like a series of booking tropes. But there is the difficult transition away from more established people in the card who are like fucking ready for the knacker's yard and younger people coming through. And there is that difficulty of that. Sorry, much as I want to talk about G1.
I think this week's going to hope it's not going to turn us around fully. There's not much going on the card tomorrow. That's the Ospreay Great O'Khan one we previewed on Friday, JP. But like going into the week, there is Eddie Kingston, Tomohiro Ishii is on the card on the 26th. So what's that, Wednesday? On there. So I mean, there's also Evil versus Scenario in that card. But I can skip. I can go to Greg's. I can find something to do with myself while that's going on. The day after show, to be fair, the one on the 27th, which which is Thursday. That's got a card of Ospreay on it. So that'll feel G1, won't it? Unfortunately, you've got to sit through Sonada and Renderita to get there, and Kenta and El Fantasmo. And, you know, I'll do fair. Yeah, that's in there as well. But yeah, Hikaleo Yuzusugi. I'm still getting joy out of seeing, you know, if we're going to talk like little bright sparks in there, just Yuzusugi in there with pretty much anyone, although I do have my limits. It's still been entertaining. Kaito Kiyomiya has still, you know, got an interesting little story. It's just not enough to, you know, help things when you Chase Owens, Shota Umino looks like it's the opener to that show on that day. And it just, yeah, it just makes you lose the will to live a little bit, doesn't it? And yeah, Kevin Kelly's not been great either, as the chatter kind of saying there. Mm. He's just, I think part of the reason is he seems to feel the same way as us. Like those evil matches, he's just calling us a shoot now. He's like, this is crap. He's just like, I think he knows he's got his AEW check. So he's just like, well, I'll just say what I want now. I'll just say what I actually think, which is this fucking sucks. He's been doing that for a while, to be fair, but it's proper. There's a lot more of it now. And a lot of, there's these shows like that one on Sunday that just had no atmosphere, where it's just him on his own as well on the call. So like, if we think we're being negative today, Kevin Kelly solo commentary in an empty arena. Oof, wouldn't wish that on anyone.
Get ELP on an opener and stick him beside. They had good chemistry. I think ELP did a good job on commentary when he was there.
Just give him someone to bounce off, so just to make him a bit happier, cheer him up when Chase Owens comes out. Although he loves Chase Owens,
get JR on him, he'll cheer him up,
he'll sort it out. You need something though. Yeah, probably. Yeah, maybe that could be his way back in. But yeah, I'd love to be, like I said, I don't relish being negative on it because I was really excited for the G1, like just in general, for, you know, bit of life to come back into New Japan. But yeah, a couple of bright sparks apart. It's not really happening, but I am being kept happy in an engaged JP. I've got to throw it out there. The great work by our friend Connor
when it comes
to the G1 pick-ems we've launched on the Grappl Discord this year. You can join us over there. There's a link below. Too late to join the contest, Jeff. But yeah, I am currently second there, sitting just behind only Jamesy, who's ghetto in disguise. Hasn't watched G1 as we said, or New Japan as we said in general in 3 years. JP's on 33 points. I'm in 32 points, just behind them, tied with Andy Ogden. I think that might be alphabetical why I'm above Andy, but I don't care. That means I'm second. I'll have it. Poor Ian Hamilton is lagging behind there in last place so far in our pick-ems. But yeah, it's making things interesting. It's like, apparently I had a perfect score on Sunday. So, you know, the more boring ghetto is and the more boring this show is, apparently I get it all right. So, you know, that's at least there's that.
I love James.
But rather like the Premier
James
League.
James just wins everything.
Yeah, FPL, G1 pick-ems.
He's no one of those people. You always knew a kid in school always won those raffles. No matter fuck how many tickets you bought, you weren't winning.
James is that kid, 100%. But yeah, I do hope it turns around. I hope, like, yeah, if we can pick and choose and be in a more positive position on weekend show, JP, I think I'll be happier for it. But on the positivity note, we should move over to our last main subject before we deal with a couple of odds and ends at the end, which is Dark Side of the Ring this week. And unfortunately, that was shit as well, for fuck's sake.
Oh, I was really cross about this.
I don't know about you, Gareth, but I think the season's been great. I've really enjoyed it. Even the ones that have been maybe a bit below average, I've found little things I've liked about it. You know, we talked about the Matt Bourne episodes where it was like, okay, walking away from it. They skipped a lot of stuff, but I still enjoyed what I got presented on TV. Loved the Chris Candido episode. Thought that was really good. There's been little sleeper, you know, fun episodes on this one. Stories well told, even if, you know, we know the routine, we know what the Dark Side of the Ring kind of structure goes. And then this week they just ripped it up. Like, I don't understand what they said it was on this Abdullah the Butcher episode. Like, I know it's Dark Side of the Ring, so it's not necessarily a biography of the person you're watching. There's a specific story usually to be told within the, you know, overall career. But they fucking did Abdullah the Butcher dirty this week. I feel like they gave him, 10 minutes of lip service at the start to be like, yeah, Abdullah the Butcher was a bit scary. I went to Japan. Now it's the year 2000. Now it's 1980 again. Now it's the year 2010 again. Yeah, wasn't he scary? Oh, yeah, he opened the restaurant. Anyway, onto this fucking cunt Hannibal and his shit YouTube channel. Let's spend 45 minutes talking about that. And that's what they did. It was the most bizarre edit, and just, it felt like a different episode had been cut, and then somebody walked in and found that story for whatever reason fascinating. Oh, he cut your head, did you, in a match where you both agreed to blade and bleed over each other? Yeah, that's the issue there, not necessarily. It's nothing to do with you. Like, that entire court case could have been summed up in 5 minutes at the end. It did not need a full episode. And you were left just walking away going, like, I don't think I really learned anything about Abby's career. There's plenty of blind spots there for me with that. It was just a cursory glance at who Abdullah the Butcher was, and then this absolute fucking tosspot whining about his legal case. And then at the end of it, he's a cunt himself anyway, because he's done the same thing to other people. Like, again, give that 5 minutes at the end. Don't give the bastard a full hour of the Abdullah the Butcher documentary. I thought this was just malpractice, I thought, Gareth. Like, it was just disgraceful, really. Probably, I'd say it's the worst episode they've ever done, and it was purely the editing decision for me and the decision to highlight this non-story.
Oh, I totally agree. Like, it was so weird because, like especially for me, like, growing up, he was always one of those people that you saw in the magazines, the photos, the, you know, the blood, the forks, all as, like, you know, he just looked like this very, very interesting maniac that you were scared of. You know, if I went to a live wrestling show and I was front row and he'd come down, you would, like, be shitting yourself. So when I saw that it was like, this was the dark side of the ring, I was just like thinking, oh great, this is going to be so cool to, like, see so much stuff of, like, what happened in Puerto Rico and see so much stuff in, like, Japan and stuff. And even if it's not, like, even if it's not dark side of the ring, like, dark side of the ring stuff, classic stuff kind of thing, just more the historical side of it, and just getting to probably hear a few more stories and things from those days, and just see some old footage, and just like I don't know, potential conflict that he had with certain individuals backstage, or things that doesn't necessarily needed to have been, like, you know, like Bruiser Brody levels or anything like that, but just more just like understanding the personal relationships that he had with different people and things, because he was such sort of like a complex character who presented himself in a certain way, even like within the industry as well as without it. So when suddenly we were at this point where I was like, hang about, what, we're already at old Abdullah the Butcher in some high school gym somewhere or something, yeah, like that. Like, what? Like this? And like literally the same as you. Like, it was this guy, and like that just been dragged out. Like, it was a 5 minute piece, wasn't it? That somehow became the vast, what the story of the whole documentary was about. And it was just not like nothing, just not like something that was major to warrant being the central piece of an entire, like, some sort of mini documentary. But also, for a person who'd achieved what Abdullah Butcher has achieved in his career, there's got to be more interesting, like compelling stories, narratives, personalities, people you can talk to, people who traveled in cars with him and things like that, that could, like, tell you so much more about it than this. Like, what a miss, huge miss. I agree. Worst ever.
Yeah, 3 for 3 on that. I think it felt like a fucking stitch up job, because how much time was spent of Hugo Savinovich and Mick Foley going, I didn't know he'd said that, and just sort of wanting to keep quiet, because it's just going, are we kind of performing this character assassination on this old man, basically? He was pulling a Harry Redknapp defense. I don't know how to do this. Like, you know,
I don't know how to read or write. I mean, you've got a restaurant, mate, with a menu on it. Bollocks in it.
All those
I kind of respect that. I respect
it. Didn't have too much of an education, no. But there's all this stuff, like, he's appearing on Japanese TV and he's like this popular culture figure and all these other things to influence. Just skate past that. And the whole thing relies on you working the idea that Hannibal, poor, sweet, innocent Hannibal, doesn't really know anything about blading. And it's like, fuck you. I was aware of that at 15 years old. You were wrestling for that long. It was bullshit. I didn't know, because this was made by Vice Canada at the end, and it came up with like Ottawa film. But like, for some reason, it's just like, well, he's in Canada, you know, we're just going to do all this stuff together as well. And it was just like, it was also simultaneously very, very depressing, because I felt bad for laughing at his brother. But like, he's a sight to behold, with like yeah, the Hogan moustache, like, as well, and squeaky voice. I was like, is he taking the piss? Like, I didn't know, like, Kurt Cobain on Top of the Pops or something. It's like he's going to go completely off piece.
He was this week's Ricky Johnson, wasn't he? Saw man Ricky Johnson was Abby's brother.
He's trying to get, I don't think he got 2.3 million in him as well, like for all of this stuff. And it's just like the comments is that I hope he fucking dies a slow and painful death because I want my money. Like what I do. It was like the worst aspects of some of the, and we're thinking the week before, all the interesting talking heads, people I haven't used before, and it went straight into what Billy bullshitters can we get around the place. I was just impressed that Tony Atlas didn't mention feet. That's tough for him.
He went back to the well of his, oh, well, it was real in Japan, though. You know, when we were out there, it was, you know, fuck off, Tony. Like, just
stories from that they could have spoken about as well. Like, I just think the whole, like, Abby in Japan, Abby in Puerto Rico, there's so much more interesting stuff from that. Like, why was he big? Him in WCW doesn't get a mention. They showed the Chamber of Horrors. There's stuff they could have mined out about. Oh, this is the downturn of him as well.
Oh, yeah. You know,
all this kind of interesting stuff they could have done about this guy who was like a massive money drawing heel. And, you know, they've done all these episodes of people like that before, like, you know, Bruiser Brody and the like. But for this one, it just did him a massive disservice. And it's not like I'm a massive Abdullah the Butcher fan, but it's just like, fucking hell, boys. Really half-assed this. It's Bam. It made me fearful because it's Bam Bam Bigelow next week, and I fucking love it. When we went to our favorite wrestlers ever, he was my number five. So fucking love him. And I'm worried that it's gonna be like shit.
This felt like an aberration. Because the episode last week was so good. That was the thing that I hate so much because it was such a shame coming off what I thought was the best episode of the season the week before, and then we go to this because it has. I don't know if you'd agree, Gareth. I think it's been a good series. I know we've been on here and we've been negative about some of the episodes before. Sometimes maybe they don't go deep enough, but there's just been a good balance this year of like stories I didn't know versus maybe some familiar stuff, but like the Candido stuff. But I still learned stuff with them. I still found the talking heads engaging. You know, they mixed it up, like JP said, with the talking heads. Brett turning up this season, and you know, the Candido one had a lot of like family members and stuff. The twins on the last one, on the Adrian Adonis one, like that whole story was like fascinating. Like, I think they deserve the benefit of the doubt. I just hope this was a rare mess.
Yeah, I totally agree. I've loved this series, and I think it's a big part of it has just because there has just been like newer stuff in there, and it's a bit different. It has veered away from like what you'd probably like if you sat down and you wrote a list, like the ones that came up in seasons 1, 2, and 3 are probably things that would have dominated lists that we'd have probably like written ourselves. You know, there's things that you did know about, things like, you know, the Matt Bourne episode, like there was plenty there that, you know, wasn't included that I thought could have been included, but as a standalone, and I thought it was a really good episode in itself. I think some of the interactions that they've had this season with like family members and things has been something that's been really powerful. Like they've not just been leaning on the wrestlers, and I think you've found a bit more out about people's like personal lives and things like that, and their personal interactions with like their, you know, children or like partners and things that I think's been really good. But I think one of the big things for me has just been, it's that like historical learning. And it's probably why there's that element for me that was a bit disappointed in the Abdullah the Butcher one there, is because there's things that I know on a surface level, but you just want like that meat under the bones. Like the Adrian Adonis stuff, just a lot of those people, like just these journeyman wrestlers and things like that. You love like the little bits that come with them. Like that, I think my favorite episode of this series actually has been the Eddie Graham episode. Like, cause I'm a proper junkie for that. Like the old, like territories kind of almost a bit like mafioso almost in like the small little areas and the way it's all run and the little interrelationships and all that. Like I love that. So that was like brilliant. Just getting that kind of like deep sort of dive into way that was all put together. And like, so again, I think any opportunity you get to put that level of depth in is great. Just, you know, don't want to hear about some fucking indie lad.
No, we would have made it. No, we would have been the next Stone Cold Steve Austin if it hadn't. Just fucking pull the other one, mate. How many people got that story? Nigel McGuinness' story. Like, there's a million people who didn't pass the WWE medical or whatever. It doesn't mean he was ever. How that judge gave him. I'm giving him too much breathing room, too much space here and time, but how that judge gave him $3.5 million, was it?
2.3 million. Fucking ridiculous. I mean, Rian's hit the businesspost.ie. Rian. Should say that he's mentioned here in the chat the Jannetty one we've got coming up in a couple of weeks, so, and that could be all manner of a fucking train wreck. isn't it?
So we're like, building up to that, aren't we? Like, I just feel like,
oh, we've got WCW the finger poker doom, and we bash to the beach 2000, and we'll all need a shower after that once. You know? So that's gonna be fucking horrible.
100%.
But there's a big enough story there with Abdullah the Butcher that, like, if it's like somebody who's this top heel, even just drawing money all over the world, and if it's now penniless and like been looked after kind of thing, that's a dark side of the ring, is that you've got this, it's the fame, it's the riches to the rags or whatever. You know, there's something there that you could have framed this story differently to present a more interesting story sort of thing, but hey, whatever.
The fact that he's just a nice old Canadian man, like that was kind of when they first took the mask off, I was like, oh, more, you know, I want that, like, oh yeah, people thought I was terrifying, but I'm actually just this lovely old man. They just, no, they moved on way, way too quickly. Yeah, felt a bit like children in need, yeah, maybe a little bit as well. Maybe that's part of it. That is a negative of it. I think it was Sale in our Discord say that about, like, the positive of the families being involved is we're hearing these different perspectives. The negative is, as we saw with the Matt Bourne, how dark are they going to get when, you know, the family are involved? You know, they're probably not going to want to tell certain stories or, you know, cover certain things. There's a balance there too, isn't there? Maybe that's part of it, and they wanted to raise money for Abby or something like that. It almost turned into a bit of a telethon, but like I say, it really took away from his career, really, by doing it that way. But yeah, that was it. Dark Side of the Ring this week. Any other wrestling we can mention, JP? Anything we can be positive about to end on a positive note that you've seen? I'll save the SmackDown talk this week. I've got nothing to say on it. It was a FS1 show that apparently did 1.2 million. Mm. So, you know, Roman draws again. That's the lesson we learned from this week's SmackDown. What else have you been watching?
So the couple of things that, I didn't get to see Stardom 5-star Grand Prix, because that started on day one, but that doesn't end until September. It's ridiculous. They dragged that out for fucking ages. So yeah, they always do with that. They just drag it out for ages. So I haven't had a chance to see it yet. What I did see, and it's more for the kind of novelty, is Chris Brookes winning the DDT KOD Openweight Champion.
Sarah's still up, Gareth. Can she come and join us? Or sorry, go on, Jimmy.
And I'd love to hear her thoughts, and if you made her watch, especially the lads and the giant pandas and the rest of it. It's a show from Sumo Hall as well. So this was Yuji Hino versus Chris Brookes. I mean, Chris Brookes has been out there, he's been lived out there throughout the pandemic. So he's obviously fluent in Japanese. I have to say that a cracking pre-match video package. They're about 3,500 there, which is good for them. It's one of their bigger shows. They're still trying to get their feet on the ground as much as anything. And they had English commentary for this as well, which they were doing a good job of trying to build me into the story of the match, but it wasn't a story that I was particularly like kind of mad about. As a match, I'd say it's like 3.5 stars, which for you two wouldn't surprise me to say that I'm talking about like kind of Chris Brookes, because he's gotten better, he's gotten bigger. Not by all that much. He did, yeah. He had some blue top milk, basically. But he's not. That's really the question here, rather than the match itself, because usually Hino is like a big bloke. So it was more or less he was like kind of bullying him, and he felt like he was like and he'd beaten him recently in a couple of matches. So he had to kind of get past him as well, and he did. But I don't think it was in a way that kind of escalated him to anything else. I mean, Chris mentioned here in the chat that Matt Cardona was on it, and he came out with one of the WWE women's tag titles that he borrowed off Chelsea Green, which is quite
apparently
funny.
A replica.
I didn't see it. Oh, is it a replica?
That's what they're saying. That's what Chelsea Green is there. Felt compelled to tweet because what a fucking cunt. Like, if he really did that,
it still makes me laugh. The idea that he would he'd be doing that the whole time. But I mean, I think as a match, I thought, oh, we're going to see some like massive improvement. It was fine. It might have been just the stylistic kind of clash between it. Like, there's much better workers in DDT that you could have gone up against. And you might imagine a match against Takeshita. Like, what would that be like? But here, it didn't feel like any sort of spectacular growth. It was more, he's been there. He's shown real loyalty. He's stuck with them. They were like showing him getting quite emotional in the pre-match video package. He won. Do I expect him to see him turn up in New Japan? Really, but there is a value to, you know, a foreign wrestler who can speak fluent Japanese and is willing to work a number of kind of styles. And if nothing else, that's what you're going to be doing in DDT. And he's bet on himself, and it's worked out. It's like Drew Parker when he had done that. Now, the issue is he's sort of, I don't know where Drew Parker is. He still does death matches if he's in the States. Not quite sure. For Brookes, it feels like, well, he's out there for a while at least doing this. But is this the height of really where he's going to be in Japan? And I suspect really the answer is yes. This is going to be like the career highlight.
Which is NXT UK and be out of a job by now, wouldn't he?
Exactly.
Like, he's outlived NXT UK. Like, yeah. He's run out there.
If anything, there's kind of like, if this is his big run with it and he decides then to come back and base himself out of the UK, there would be in it like him going into a Rev Pro. I know we all have our thoughts about whether or not that'd be something, but I think it would be a boost necessarily. I think he, you know, him in terms of him as a character, he comes out to like a different version of Human Fly by the Cramps as well. It's not the same one that we used to hear all the time when he was here.
I mean, I wasn't a huge, I wasn't a huge Chris Brookes fan, like, at all. You know, my wife's even less of a Chris Brookes fan, but he's one of those where you just look at him and then you see what he's done and he's, like, achieving that. When I saw that at the weekend, I just thought, well, like, fair fucks to you. Like, you know, he's somebody who's got his own mind, he's got a creative mind, he's got his own direction that he wants to go in and things like that. And, like, and he's gone off the beaten track, and that's what we'd have said on here 3 years ago, 4 years ago. Don't go to that gym in Enfield, go and do something off your own back, go and make a name for yourself on, you know, in a different way, and learn other stuff and learn from other people and things like that. And he's done that, you know, and like to the point where, like, that if he was back here now when he was on a show, I'd have intrigue. I'd want to see what's he learned, how's he developed, what does he look like now, what's his match structure going to be like, is it, and things like that. So, you know, there would be that kind of like pull and interest, as opposed to, you know, 99.9% of the lads who just got signed up and were on NXT UK that you're just like, oh yeah, I know you, I know what you do, and I know who you've been amongst for that time period. You just feel like, fair shout to the lad. And I mean, you see the things of him, like him posting photos of himself with like DGT posters on his wall when he's in his teens and things like that. And you just like, it's like live the dream there, basically, hasn't he? Kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So yeah, good.
One of us.
Like, good on him. Good on him.
Yeah.
That's why he, like, he always, you know, works. So, you know, he had that fan base that would follow him around the show. You know, we made fun of the shouting with the kids and all of that stuff. But there's a reason he had that connection, because, you know, he was on CGW fans, that message board, while I was on like the ROH message board. He's of that generation, you know, just obviously a bit younger. And yeah, he's, like I say, he made, you know, creatively, while maybe as a wrestler he's never really been for me, you can't help but, like, you know, tip your hat to the things that he created. You know, we leave the merch stuff, we laugh at that too, but, you know, think of the money and the lads whose career.
I bought plenty of his merch, despite not being a fan, because it's fucking cool. He's got his finger on the pulse, like, and
he has, you know. And, you know, Aussie Open, you know, that you've got to, if you're going to talk about that group of lads, like, they're not the success they are if they don't come across Chris Brookes. Like, you know, he's a massive part of their story as well. And they're killing it now with their, you know, AEW deal and the fact that they're, you know, pretty much set in America now. And let's hope they get off ROH TV. But, you know, that's a success story too. And yeah, a lot of the lads who were in Enfield are back on the scene, aren't they? And not doing much. So yeah, definitely, if we're going to criticize them, we've got to give credit where it's due to him. I was just going to
say, they can be involved in the six-man tag at the Schadenfreude six-man tag, can't they, at Ref Pro?
Oh.
Point to bring him back, wouldn't you? You could have that Aussie Open and Chris Brookes, wouldn't it?
Like, maybe for the big show, yeah, I could see that. I could picture that definitely if he's here for the weekend. But I was going to say quickly, a quick news note before we go, JP. Have you seen the breaking news that Roosh has done a tweet saying that he's started a new chapter in his personal professional career? People doubted he could make it, but he wants to say that he is 100% AEW as he signs a contract, like a wrestler on deadline day or a footballer on deadline day in his shiny blue suit. I'm looking at him right now. He's chosen to stick with Tony Khan, do you think? And thought he'd go to WWE and get to WrestleMania, and, you know, Vince McMahon would love him and there'd be no issues. There we go. Bit of breaking news for you.
6 months he'll be kicking off. I bet he was a bastard throughout the entire negotiations. I've got Manuel Adebayor signing a contract at Spurs and then immediately downing tools. That's what I'm getting the vibe from here as well. He's a piss taker of the highest order, and I can't help but fucking admire him. I really can't. And it just goes through the family strength, because they just do this shit all the time. I don't even know to him if he's already working out a way how to get out of that contract. Like, he's just that kind of bloke, isn't he? It's the scorpion and the frog. It's in his nature. Just gonna go there.
Now rule
safer style. Fuck you. Like, I'm just gonna throw lads about a ringside like it's Arena Mexico, and I give less of a shit. God love him.
Spreading out and taking over, as he says there. LFI taking over the wrestling world. There you go. So there you go. Bit of a positive news for you there. Will mentions actually as well. Yeah, we didn't say that there, but Chris Brooks. He's literally the person who put Aussie Open together as a team. Yeah. Oh yeah, he did. That's all he ever did. Like, that's a massive thing. You've got to give him credit for as well. But yeah, outside of that, I think that sums us up for the week. Anything to plug, lads? We can't. We used to plug the Twitters, didn't we? At this point, can't we? We plug the X or X accounts now, which is. Apparently, I think if you want to do some current day banter, the fuck's going on there? It'll last a day, won't it? It'll be at the end of the week.
It's these cunts with their NFTs and their fucking tech coming along and talking bollocks and trying to make out this letter X somehow some like massive mystical meaning.
Oh, brilliant. Well, there you go. X.com/BensonRichard, I suppose. And it's a plug, JP.
All roads lead to patreon.com/grapple. As we mentioned at the start of the show, we have the deep cut on Lex Luger. Obviously, before then, we've got all of the other stuff that we've covered in the meantime. Straight to the 5-1, best heels, best wrestling video games. We had that out not too long ago as well. We've got the weekend shows, we've got daily updates, town hall coming up, exciting stuff.
All going on. Gareth, anything to plug these days?
What JP said.
Fair enough. Summed it up. There you go. So there we are for another week. Thanks for jumping on again, Gareth, and getting through all the homework. But same again next week. Yeah, week after that, we'll see. Collision that pulled you back in. Though? We'll see. We'll get you back on again very soon to get your thoughts. We got all in coming up. Plenty of content coming on the Patreon that we'll definitely have you part of as well. But yeah,
when you start to feel like you're getting a bit too positive, just get me back on.
Tell us everyone shit. That's standard Jungle Boy segment. Yeah, I think that could be a winner there. Although, yeah, there's probably no danger of us getting too positive, I don't think, JP, if you believe certain circles. But yeah, patreon.com/grapple for all that good stuff. We'll be going to do a quick post show with our patrons. In the pre-show, we were chatting a bit of the Barbie movie, among other things. So if that's that floats your boat, patreon.com/grapple for the extended version of the show. But yeah, that'll do for the main spotlight show. We will catch you again next Monday. Take care, folks.
Bye.